February 7th, 1984, Columbus, Ohio. An intern at the State University Hospital checked on a 69-year-old woman recovering from routine back surgery. No one knows why Dr. Michael Swango was in the room, perhaps just to say hello. When he left, Rena Cooper seemed to be doing fine. As she was being stabilized, Rena struggled to tell the doctors what happened.
Let you write a note to us, okay?
She wrote, "The doctor put something in my IV."
That was Dr. Swango. When I was over there, I was taking some notes.
What was Dr. Swango doing?
While this is going on, we know that another nurse decided to walk down the hall to calm the other patients since there was a great deal of commotion. And four rooms down within minutes sees Dr. Swango exiting another room with a very funny grin on his face, and those are her words, not mine. The nurse goes into that room and finds a large hypodermic needle with the plunger down sitting on the sink, which is not very unusual. You wouldn't expect that in a hospital. Hypodermics aren't left lying around.
Oh, Mike, good. Glad you're here. I need to talk to you for a second.
Three different doctors confronted Michael Swango about what had happened in Rena Cooper's room. Swango allegedly told three different stories. At one point, he claimed he had never even been in the room.
She just had a surgery. It's common for patients just out of surgery to be delusional.
Most of us tend to hold doctors to a higher standard, and perhaps that's fair. After all, we are sometimes compelled to trust them implicitly, depending on their knowledge and expertise to save our lives. Did Michael Swango betray that trust for his own sadistic pleasure? If you ask Swango, he'd probably tell you he was a victim of bad luck and circumstance. But unfortunately, the question cannot be posed. No one can find Michael Swango. Michael Swango came to Ohio as a recent graduate of the medical school at Southern Illinois University. He projected charm and confidence despite a lackluster med school record.
Michael Swango became more and more withdrawn as he proceeded through his college classes and eventually got into medical school. And though academically he did very well, the more the classes became advanced and the more he needed to do hands-on patient work, the more he pulled away from that to the point where he was held back a year.
Take a look at one of these appraisals and you can see what I'm talking about.
Swango's poor performance continued through the first 6 months of his internship.
Dr. Swango, the end result is, unless you have a significant improvement, you will not be allowed to take the next step.
Are you saying you may not recommend me for residency? I've been working my entire life to be a doctor.
Swango's lifelong goal was now jeopardized. It could mean he would never become a full-fledged doctor. It was shortly after Swango was put on probation that Rena Cooper suffered her mysterious seizure. It was one of a series of puzzling events at the hospital that spring. Rena Cooper survived, but at least five other patients died.
The five mysterious respiratory arrests in the last month in the neurosurgery wing has caused quite an alarm among all of us. I'm aware of that. I've decided to see if there's some sort of pattern to this situation, and I've developed a chart.
The upshot of it is that whenever these incidents occurred, Swango is always there. A black cloud seems to follow Michael Swango.
Black, destitute of light, devoid of color, enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal or gloomy, as the future looked black.
A black cloud seems to follow Michael Swango. Wherever Swango was, there was an unexplained respiratory arrest, and it didn't happen once or twice, it happened five, six, seven times.
Though some evidence appeared to point to Swango, hospital officials chose not to call the police. They decided to watch him closely and quietly wait out the last months of his internship.
I think the kid was great. I think I was better, but I think the kid was great.
Chicken!
Food, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Swango did not appear disturbed by the hospital's decision to let him go or the whispered allegations against him. In fact, on several occasions during the last months of his internship, he treated staff members to what he called extra spicy chicken.
We know that from interviews with three doctors, they became violently ill within hours of eating the spicy chicken. So ill, in fact, that they needed treatment for their eyes from ruptured blood vessels from the vomiting.
Michael Swango left OSU Hospital in June of 1984 without being formally investigated. No charges have ever been filed. 1 month later, Swango had a new job, not as a doctor, but as a paramedic. On September 14th, he brought donuts for the whole crew.
I grabbed a donut, started eating the donut. But I noticed there was something different about the donut. It didn't spring back up like most donuts do.
You all right in there?
45 minutes later, Brett and several others became very ill. They wanted to test the leftover donuts, but they had disappeared. Only an empty box remained.
No one had any suspicions of Mike at all at that time. They figured that that was food poisoning. Since the donuts were gone and they couldn't analyze it, they just more or less thought that that's what it was and let it go by at that.
Well, the next night I worked with Mike at a football game, a local football game. At halftime, he offered to buy me a soda. I started sipping the soda at halftime, and by the start of the third quarter, I became deathly sick.
Yet another mysterious illness made Swango's co-workers increasingly suspicious. They also couldn't help noticing Swango's grisly fascination with accidents and death.
Brent?
The gorier the better.
Is she breathing?
He would describe his ultimate calls as a paramedic. And that would be a busload of children hitting head-on with a tanker truck and igniting. And as he's approaching the scene, he would see charred bodies out of the windows of the buses. Bodies that are up against the barbed wire fence, caught in the barbed wire fences. I mean, this is, to me, I thought was really strange. Just, you know, to want to see death.
No, just stay calm, man.
Finally, the paramedics decided to fake a call to get Swango out of the building. They wanted him away long enough to search his locker. In Michael Swango's gym bag, his co-workers found two bottles of ant poison. One full, one empty.
Poison.
Michael Swango?
Yes.
I am Detective Reynolds. These are officers DeWitt and Rogers. We have a warrant. Search the premises. Paul, why don't you start with you?
In Swango's apartment, police discovered more incriminating evidence. Dozens of bottles of poisons, books on poisons, recipe cards for making poisons, and an assortment of syringes. One syringe was full of ant poison. The evidence was overwhelming. Swango was convicted of 6 counts of aggravated battery and sentenced to 5 years in prison. After serving half his sentence, he was given time off for good behavior. Amazingly, Swango again found work in the healthcare field. He was apparently able to convince employers that he had been the victim of a miscarriage of justice. In Newport News, Virginia, he turned up at a medical vocational school. There, 3 of his colleagues reportedly fell ill. Swango then talked his way into the University of South Dakota Hospital. Again, he was shadowed by his past and dismissed. Finally, in August of 1993, Swango resurfaced to Stony Brook University in New York. He was assigned to a Veterans Administration hospital on Long Island. While there, he changed his name to Michael Kirk.
He was accepted into the Stony Brook program, and they never bothered to check him with a central registry for medical residents, which apparently had a file that was an inch thick on him. There were 180 people who applied for 12 slots, and he managed to get one of those 12 slots despite these clouds of questionable activity that followed him in at least 4 states.
I know all about the Negro clouds, I'm going to tell you. I'm very familiar with the Negro clouds. Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy, Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy for non-white people, victims of white supremacy. Brand new book on the book club. Whew. I wanted to read this book a year ago. In fact, about a year and a half ago at this point. We got sidetracked with all that malarkey and Man in the High Castle and all that other nonsense. Any hoodles. Whew. Time is right and exact. We were supposed to read this book later. It is so much more relevant now than it was last year. Now, I saw that unsolved mystery segment that you heard, the late Robert Stack. I saw that last year and said, oh, wow, I wonder if there's more information. I found this book. Said, we should read this book right now. Whew. Man, oh, man. There's so much to say. I will just go quick so we can go ahead and get to the audio. I just said that was Season 8, Unsolved Mysteries. You didn't even hear the full episode and all of the pertinent details. So much more to come. Ohio State, their marching band playing in the background. This will be 1, 2, 3, 4 in a row all the way back to Dave Cullen. That was in the springtime. And then that got followed up with Sue Klebold and Tom Klebold. They are both alumni at The Ohio State. And then we just read about old Jeffrey Dahmer, who spent that brief amount of time there before he decided what was important to him. This will make 4 in a row, hearing about Mr. Swango. And this is going to be, I think, 4 in a row for the Anarchist Cookbook? This is going to be 4 in a row for Psychopathology. Whew. You can look for the other patterns that just ripple out from all of this. In fact, where did Michael Swango end up after all was said and done with everything? If you are a really tough white dude and you blow up the Olympics or you blow up a federal building or an airplane, they just can't do anything with you, where do they send you? Rocky Mountain Boom! Maybe that's what Colorado means. That's for really, 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 really bad white people. You go out there and sit in your jail cell and root on Prime and the Colorado Buffaloes. Hope Russell Wilson, Broncos, get their act together. We will get started. James B. Stewart. Blind Eye, not to be confused with The Blind Eye. Whew. Man, oh man. Cannot wait. Audio segment number 1. We just talked about Harold Shipman at the beginning of the year. Keep in mind, does this qualify for iatrogenic death? Audio segment 1, Katherine Massey Book Club.
Blind Eye by James B. Stewart. I observe the physician with the same diligence as he the disease. John Donne, 1572 to 1631. Prologue. Cnaeus Mzeswa had dozed off for a nap that May afternoon, but was awakened at about 2 p.m. when he felt someone removing his loose-fitting pajama trousers. He lifted his head, still a bit groggy from sleep, and saw that it was Dr. Mike. The handsome American doctor had a syringe in his hand and seemed about to give him an injection. So Mzeswa, eager to help, pulled down his trousers and turned on his side. Then the doctor plunged the unusually large needle into his right buttock. Mzezwa saw that after he finished the injection, the doctor concealed the used syringe in the pocket of his white medical coat. "Goodbye," Dr. Mike said softly, pausing briefly to look back at Mzezwa. Then he left the hospital ward. Howard Mpofu, the director of hospitals for the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Zimbabwe, liked the new doctor the minute he met him. In November 1994, when he picked him up at the Bulawayo City Airport, Michael Swango looked like the American athletes Mpofu had seen on television. He was blonde and blue-eyed, taller than Mpofu, with a ready smile. According to the resume the church had received, he was 40 years old, but he looked younger. Mpofu tried to help Swango with his duffel bags, but the doctor wouldn't hear of it. He quickly hoisted the heavy bags and insisted on carrying them to the car himself. On the ride into the city, Swango was garrulous, flushed with excitement at his new assignment. Mpofu asked why Swango had wanted to come to Zimbabwe to take up a post that would pay him a small fraction of what he could earn in the United States. After all, Swango was an honor student. He'd graduated from an American medical school and had completed an internship at the prestigious Ohio State University hospitals, which meant he could go anywhere. "All my life," Swango told him, "I have dreamed of helping the poor and the disadvantaged." He said America had plenty of doctors, but in Africa, he would be truly needed. Mpofu couldn't agree with that. I couldn't argue with that. When they reached the Lutheran Church headquarters in central Bulawayo, they walked up one flight of stairs to the church offices, and Mpofu introduced Swango to the Lutheran Bishop of Zimbabwe. To the amazement of the church officials, Swango knelt before the bishop and kissed the floor. He said he was so grateful to have been hired and to be in Zimbabwe at last. The bishop seemed equally delighted. Indeed, he and Mpofu were overjoyed simply to have succeeded in recruiting an American doctor from one of their mission hospitals, let alone willing to kiss the ground at their feet. Before Swango, the only European or American doctors the church had succeeded in bringing to Zimbabwe were evangelical Lutherans from church headquarters in Sweden, and none of them stayed more than a few years. Not many foreign doctors, even from places like Eastern Europe and Asia, wanted to come to Zimbabwe, the former British colony of Rhodesia, which lies between Mozambique and Botswana, just north of South Africa. Before the end of the white supremacist regime of Ian Smith and the holding of supervised elections in 1980, the country had endured a prolonged civil war. And after independence came the consolidation of dictatorial power by the mercurial Robert Mugabe, who, among other controversial pronouncements, has denounced homosexuals as, quote, perverts, who are, quote, worse than dogs and pigs, end quote. Since independence, the country has experienced the suppression of human rights, the collapse of its currency, a steep decline in the standard of living, and the immigration of much of its white population. Fully 25% of the adult population of Zimbabwe is estimated to be infected with HIV, the highest infection rate in the world. At times, the country's hospital system has been plunged into turmoil, and there is a critical shortage of doctors. With a population of about 650,000, Bulawayo is Zimbabwe's second largest city, the capital of the province of Matabeleland, once a powerful African nation in its own right. For the most part, the local population speaks Ndebele, a linguistic cousin of Zulu, whereas the Zimbabweans' majority speak Shona. A debilitating civil war between the two ethnic groups broke out almost immediately after Zimbabwe gained independence. And though a truce was reached, simmering tensions persist. Bulawayo residents complain that the city has been neglected by the national government because of continuing ethnic discrimination against the Ndebele. But a result of that neglect has been that the colonial era architecture and city plan have been largely unmarred by the building boom that has swept Harare, the nation's capital. Even the cars generally date from the 50s and 60s, owing to years of international economic embargo during white supremacist rule and the collapse of the Zimbabwean dollar following independence. Many people in Bulawayo seem to prefer the atmosphere of faded gentility, especially the 50,000 or so remaining whites, most of British descent. These days, few live lavishly. There is little conspicuous wealth. But they praise the city's unhurried pace. Nearly all businesses seem to close by 3 p.m. The nearly ideal climate of the high African veldt, in which each summer temperatures almost nearly reach 90 degrees. The gracious residential neighborhoods of walled villas and jacaranda-lined streets. Most white people still return for a lunch prepared by black servants. They congregate at the Bulawayo Golf Club, the oldest club in Zimbabwe, with manicured fairways and a swimming pool, and the Bulawayo Club, an imposing Beaux Art mansion downtown. By contrast, the orderly grid of colonial Bulawayo is surrounded by scores of, quote, settlements, in which thousands of black people live crowded into small houses and shanties along dirt roads that seem to have been laid down at random. Many commute into the city on aging, diesel fume-spewing buses, and the central bus terminal is a colorful and chaotic mass of shouting passengers, piles of goods and luggages, buses, taxis, bicycles, and hand carts. There is an almost eerie sense of time of a time warp in Bulawayo. In the warm, award-winning 1988 film, A World Apart, it stood in for 1960s Johannesburg. Swango spent his first night in Zimbabwe at the Selborne, a colonial-era hotel whose wide veranda overlooks the city's bustling central square. The next morning, Mpofu picked him up for the drive to the church's mission hospital at Manene. Mpofu had made the six-hour drive many times, and he was accustomed to the dismay of first-time visitors as the pavement gave way to a dirt road so rough that a four-wheel drive vehicle or truck is required. Yet Swango voiced no complaints as they ventured even farther from what most Americans would consider civilization. Nene, a cluster of buildings, can't be found on many maps. It lies in the region of Mberengwa, in south-central Zimbabwe, in what in colonial times were known as the tribal lands of Belengwe. In the heart of the bush, inhabitants identify themselves by the name of their tribal chief. The land is still owned communally, and the local people's lives of subsistence farming has changed little for generations. There are no towns to speak of, scant electricity, almost no telephones. Most people live in extended family units in clusters of mud-walled buildings with thatched roofs. The landscape is often stunningly beautiful. Verdant valleys give way to distant panoramas of mountain ranges. Drought and malaria are constant threats, in part because of the lower elevation makes the climate more tropical than it is on the high plateau where most of the white population lives. The region is served by three hospitals, one of them also called Manene, all founded in the early part of the century by evangelical Lutheran missionaries. Manene Mission Hospital, a cluster of one-story whitewashed buildings with corrugated metal roofs and wide verandas, is set atop a hill with distant views and refreshing breezes. The buildings look much the same as they do in a photograph taken in 1927. When the hospital was built. When Mpofu and Swango finally arrived, Dr. Christopher Dashiri, the hospital director, hurried out to greet them, he introduced Swango to Dr. Jan Larsson, a Swedish missionary doctor who was the other member of Menene's medical staff, and showed Swango to his quarters, a spacious bungalow with a veranda adjacent to the hospital. Zishiri is a native Zimbabwean. Under the country's system of socialized health care, he reported to the provincial medical administrator in Gweru and was paid by the government, even though nominally he worked for the Lutheran Church. Even more than others, Zishiri thought it was almost too good to be true that they had managed to recruit an American doctor to a place like Nene. Zishiri and Swango soon became friends. Zishiri couldn't get over how talkative Swango was, always eager for deep conversation and filled with curiosity. After his arrival, Swango had garnered glowing reports from patients and staff members. He was soon known to everyone as Dr. Mike. It was true that he lacked experience in general, surgery and obstetrics, two areas most in demand in Menene. After a month at Menene, Zishiri sent him to Mpelo Hospital in Bulawayo, where Swango spent the next 5 months gaining additional clinical experience. The doctors at Mpelo wrote glowing recommendations, and Swango was far more confident and proficient when he returned to Menene in late May. He was seen as a nearly tireless worker, able to complete 48-hour stints without sleep. He even worked extra shifts, giving up his free time. Of course, at Menene, there was little less to do. Even the indefatigably cheerful Swango finally complained about the isolation, asking Zishiri if the church could possibly provide him with use of a car, since he couldn't afford one. Fearful that Swango might decide to leave, Zishiri wrote church officials a letter asking whether there wasn't some way that they could accommodate him. Swango often made extra rounds to check on his patients, sometimes at night or during afternoons when he was otherwise off duty. So when Dr. Swango arrived in the surgery recovery room on May afternoon in 1995 to check on Kanae's Mazeswe, the only patient there, no one thought it unusual, even though Swango had already completed his rounds that morning, and technically, Mzeswa wasn't his patient. Mzeswa had recently had his foot amputated by Dr. Larsson, a farmer in the Marimbergwa area who was also a part-time laborer at the nearby Sandawana Emerald Mine. Mzeswa had come to the hospital the previous week complaining about severe pains in his leg. A tall, slender man with a wide smile, Mzeswa had reacted calmly to the news that his infected foot would be amputated. The doctor reassured him that he would be fitted with a prosthesis and should be able to lead a normal life once he returned to his farmstead. The operation had been uneventful, but Mzeswa once had been kept in the recovery ward for close monitoring, which was routine in amputation cases. Dr. Larsson had been pleased with his progress and mentioned to Zishiri how well Mzeswa was doing. That afternoon, Mzeswa was awakened from his nap by the new doctor, Dr. Mike. Before the doctor gave him the injection, Mzeswa noticed he neglected to swab the skin with disinfectant. Mzeswa also noticed that when Dr. Mike put the used syringe in his jacket pocket, the needle's cover fell to the floor near his bed. Still, it seemed a routine visit. Despite the large size of the needle, Mzeswa didn't mind the pain. He relaxed and lay back on his bed, prepared to resume his nap. But as the drug given by him by the doctor spread through his body, he began to feel a strange loss of sensation in all his muscles. With mounting alarm, he realized that he couldn't turn over and couldn't move his arms or legs. He wanted to speak or cry out, but his jaws, tongue, and throat wouldn't respond. Then the room, brightly lit by the afternoon sun, grew dim. Soon all was darkness. Mzeswa didn't know how much time passed while he lay there, alive and conscious, but paralyzed and terrified. But then the darkness began to lift. He could see, though he still couldn't move his head. A nurse's aide entered the recovery ward and came over to his bedside. She held a thermometer and told him it was time to take his temperature. Mzeswa's mind was racing. His heart beat furiously. He wanted to cry out, but he couldn't make a sound. He couldn't hear the aide, but he couldn't move. He could hear the aide, but he couldn't move. His muscles wouldn't respond. She asked him to move his arm so she could put the thermometer in his armpit. He lay motionless. She asked him again. Suddenly, the aide looked alarmed and ran from the ward. Moments later, Mzeswa regained his voice. He screamed and began shouting to attract attention, though he still could not produce recognizable words. A nurse came rushing into the ward, followed by the aide. She came and stroked his hand, trying to calm him, asking him what had happened, but he was still unable to speak. Two more nurses arrived. Slowly, Mzeswa regained his voice. "Dr. Mike gave me an injection," he finally gasped. The nurses were puzzled. For while Mzeswa was taking oral pain-killing medication, he was not scheduled for any injections. In any event, injections were administered by the nursing staff, not by the doctors. Then Swango himself came into the ward, coolly appraising the commotion. Mzeswa looked terrified. The nurses fell silent. "Did you give him an injection?" a nurse finally asked. "What was it?" Swango seemed mystified. "He must be delirious," he said. "I didn't give him any injection." Chapter 1. Southern Illinois, the triangle of land north of the junction of the Mississippi and Ohio rivers, 350 miles from Chicago, feels more like the Deep South than like the industrial Midwest. Summers are hot and steamy, and in June 1979, most of the students and faculty members at Southern Illinois University in Carbondale who could get away after graduation had fled, leaving the campus feeling sleepy and underpopulated. An exception was the medical school, whose year-round schedule enabled students to complete the standard four-year medical school curriculum in 3 years. They began during the summer, spent the first year at SIU's main campus in Carbondale, then moved to SIU's campus in Springfield, the state capital, to complete their degree. Late one June night, James Rosenthal, a newly admitted member of the SIU medical school class of 82, was sitting in a college dorm, sweating from a combination of the heat and his anxiety over an enormous stack of introductory medical texts, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry. The topics seemed endless, the books huge. He should have been asleep. He turned out the lights and noticed that another window in the adjacent dorm was still brightly lit. It was Rosenthal's classmate, Michael Swango, wearing military fatigue pants and doing jumping jacks. Swango was lean and muscled at a time when fitness was far from most students' mind. He'd been in the Marines, and his name was stenciled on the military garb he usually wore to class. It was weird, Rosenthal thought. Many of his classmates had been anti-war protesters. Swango was the only member of the class who he knew who had been in the military. Swango's military garb and fanatical devotion to fitness were noticed by just about everyone in his class at SIU. Besides the military fatigues, he wore combat boots to class. When Rosenthal and other classmates struggled out of bed in the morning after a late night of studying, they would often see Swango outdoors, doing early morning calisthenics, chanting Marine cadences. Sometimes at breakfast in the cafeteria, they teased him about his uniforms and military bearing. Swango bridled at their ribbing and increasingly kept to himself. Everyone in the class was soon nearly overwhelmed by the workload at the battery of tests administered to first-year med students. As a relatively new medical school, SIU had been able to build a curriculum from the ground up, unfettered by traditional approaches. It was the first medical school in the country to create a written set of criteria for the medical degree, criteria derived from an extensive survey of medical educators. The goal was to graduate students prepared for careers in primary care, family practice, internal medicine, pediatrics, and obstetrics gynecology, as opposed to research or the subspecialties such as ophthalmology and cardiology. Every first-year medical student was required to take and pass 476 written tests during the first year. Each test covered a curricular module, such as heart murmurs, within one of the core topics, such as the heart. 10 to 15 closed book tests were given every Saturday morning on the modules that had been covered in classes that week. Notes and textbooks weren't allowed in the exam room. That didn't deter Swango, however, from using his notes during the exam. He would choose one of the tests, take it, then choose his next text topic, and sprint from the room back into the hallway. There he would frantically page through his notes and books, cramming for the second test. Then he would return, take that test, and repeat the process. His fellow students were dumbfounded, and some were disgruntled. Dashing into the hallway between tests seemed perilously close to cheating, though it wasn't expressly forbidden. As the weeks went by, and Swango continued the pattern, several students mentioned to him that they thought it wasn't fair. But Swango was defiant and continued his cramming. Inevitably, other students began to do likewise, which led to considerable faculty concern. Finally, Chandra Banerjee, the first-year professor of pulmonary medicine, admonished his students, "God damn it, no Swangoing." A new word was coined, Swangoing, the noun, or to Swango, the verb, describing the practice of racing into the hall and cramming between tests. Swango was notorious, not only for his test-taking regimen. During the first year, medical students dissect a cadaver, a ritual familiar to every medical student. The process bonds students, and they usually remember it for the rest of their careers. At SIU, the first-year students were divided into groups, and each student was assigned one part of the cadaver to dissect and present to the rest of the group. Swango's assignment was the hip and buttock region, including the gluteus muscles. Students had keys to the anatomy lab and could come and go on their own time. Many worked late into the night, though the lab was busiest in the afternoons when faculty members were on hand to offer advice and suggestions. But Swango never came in during the day or evening, preferring to work on his dissection after midnight when the lab was usually deserted. Indeed, some members of his group who never saw him in the anatomy lab at all, wondered how he was going to make his presentation. What Swango gained in privacy from his unorthodox hours, he lost in guidance from faculty and other students. For when his presentation finally came, and he unveiled his dissection, his fellow students gasped. He had transformed the hip region of his cadaver into an unrecognizable mess of tangled flesh and bone. As some classmates described it, it was as though he had done his dissection using a chainsaw rather than a scalpel. Even Swango finally recognized that he couldn't adequately describe the region's anatomical characteristics using his own handiwork. He abandoned the cadaver and completed his presentation by showing his group pictures from an anatomy text. Swango had few, if any, friends at SIU. His fellow students later realized they knew almost nothing about his past, his family, his education, or his military service. Yet, the combination of his weird garb, chiseled physique, odd nocturnal habits, swangling, and now the cadaver mishap made him one of the best known of the 72 members of the class, much talked about and derided at the many class parties and gatherings from which he was usually absent. The cadavers remained on the display in the anatomy lab, and members of Swango's group made a point of showing their friends Swango's mangled handiwork, generally with a comment like, "Can you believe this?" One classmate, Kevin Sweeney, paraded nearly half the class through the anatomy lab to see it. The experience must have been humiliating for Swango, who had received almost nothing but praise and perfect grades before enrolling in med school. Michael was the second of Muriel and John Virgil Swango's three sons. Richard Kirkering, Muriel's son from a previous marriage, lived with his father. Michael had excelled at the private Catholic boys' high school he had attended in Quincy, Illinois, beginning in 1968. Bob and John were educated at public schools, but largely at the insistence of his mother, who recognized that he was academically gifted. Michael was enrolled in Christian Brothers High School. The family wasn't Catholic. His father once described his religion as the brotherhood of man. But Christian Brothers was perceived as academically superior to the public schools. John Virgil Swango also liked the strict ethical and moral foundation of the Catholic curriculum. He didn't want Michael to be an anti-war activist like his older brother, Bob. Virgil needn't have worried. Michael seemed oblivious to the social and political upheaval sweeping the country. While Bob listened to Bob Dylan and the Rolling Stones, Michael's favorite popular musical group was the brother-sister duo, the Carpenters. He was a model student, named to the honor roll every year. He took the usual pre-college course load, but the only topic in which he seemed to show unusual interest was the Holocaust, which he was covered in world history. He ranked in the 97th percentile on his college aptitude test. Though he ran on the track team during his freshman and sophomore years, he wasn't very athletic. He participated in a whirlwind of extracurricular activities. He was a class officer and served on the student council, yearbook, and newspaper staffs. His main interests mirrored his mother's love of music. He was a talented pianist and spent many evenings playing classical music for his mother. He was the band's first chair clarinet, as well as its president, and he sang in the glee club. As a senior, he performed the demanding Mozart clarinet concerto in the band's spring concert, the only student featured as a soloist. Mrs. Swango had bought him a buffet clarinet, an expensive brand manufactured in Paris and used by many leading players. He was so precocious that his clarinet teacher, who played in the Quincy Symphony and taught at Quincy College, recruited Michael for the Quincy College Wind Ensemble, which toured Illinois during Swango's senior year in high school. When Michael graduated from Christian Brothers in 1972, he was showered with honors, the Outstanding Musician and John Philip Sosa Bound Award, followed by a party for band members and their parents hosted by his mother, a citation as a National Merit Scholarship finalist in the place of class valedictorian, a flurry of articles in the Quincy Herald Whig, the local newspaper, memorialized his achievements. His mother clipped the articles and circulated them among relatives. A 1972 yearbook picture shows Michael in his band uniform, smiling with tousled blonde hair. Curiously, in the same yearbook, he described his ambition as to be an Illinois state trooper. As his class valedictorian and a national merit finalist with high test scores, Swango would have been highly sought after by top colleges and universities all over the country. But minimal college counseling was available in Quincy. His parents were relatively unsophisticated about higher education outside the military, and almost all his classmates stayed close to home. Consequently, Swango's horizons seemed to have been limited. He decided to attend Millikan University, a small private liberal arts school in Decatur, Illinois, about a three-hour drive from Quincy, where he received a full tuition scholarship in music. Millikan's music department was highly regarded in Illinois, and he was considered the school's strongest department, As he had in high school, Swango excelled academically at Millikan, earning nearly perfect grades during his first 2 years. But during his first year, a girlfriend broke off the relationship. Though he had typically worn a sports jacket to class, which was unusual in early 70s, after the breakup, he began to dress in military garb. He painted his old Ford Fairlane in camouflage olive green. When a friend asked him about this, he said he planned to join the military and was fascinated by guns. About this time, too, he first mentioned an interest in pre-med courses, and he showed an intense interest in photos in the local paper of car crashes, which his classmates found peculiar. By the end of his sophomore year, he was spending more time alone, and his friends and roommate had less and less contact with him. That summer, he enlisted in the Marines and didn't return for his junior year. No one ever heard him play the clarinet or the piano again. Michael completed basic training at the Marines boot camp at San Diego, where he was trained as a rifleman, earning the designation of sharpshooter. His personal record states that he entered the service at St. Louis, attended administrative procedures courses at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, and Washington, D.C., and was working at Camp Lejeune in 1976 when he received an honorable discharge. He received a National Defense Service Medal and a Meritorious Mass, a minor commendation. When he returned to Quincy after his discharge, Swango was lean and fit and carried himself with military bearing. He announced to his family that he wanted to become a physician, something that especially pleased his mother, who had once worked as a medical secretary. He enrolled in pre-med courses at the local community college and had no difficulty gaining admission to Quincy College for the following fall. A small private college founded by the Franciscan Brothers in 1860 and still affiliated with the Catholic Church, the school had long drawn applicants from students at private Catholic high schools, mostly in Illinois. But the population of such students had been dwindling. With his near-perfect grades at the more competitive Millikan and his outstanding high school record, Swango must have been one of the college's top applicants. Still, after he was admitted, he decided to embroider his record on a form he submitted to the college's public information office. He falsely claimed that he had received both a Bronze Star for heroism in combat and a Purple Heart for combat wounds during his relatively brief tenure as a Marine. Swango was an outstanding student at Quincy College. Having abandoned music, he plunged into the sciences, earning a 3.89 grade point average with a double major in chemistry and biology. He studied prodigiously, working late into the night at the college library or in the science labs. In contrast to high school, he pursued few outside activities. He didn't participate in any sports, and in yearbook, he listed the biology club at the college radio station as his only extracurricular activity. In a further reflection of his newfound interest in medicine, he worked part-time as an orderly at Blessing Hospital in Quincy and became a certified emergency medical technician. During his senior year, Swango wrote a paper, evidently his senior thesis in chemistry, on the poisoning murder of a prize-winning Bulgarian writer living in exile in London. It isn't hard to fathom why the death of Georgi Markov might have drawn Swango's attention. As the Bulgarian crossed the busy Waterloo Bridge in central London in September 1978, he felt a faint pricking on his thigh. A heavy-set man mumbled, "Sorry," to Markov, as a man stooped to pick up an umbrella he had dropped. That night, Markov developed a high fever and then violent nausea. He died 4 days later. An autopsy discovered a tiny capsule about the size of a head of a pin embedded in Markov's thigh. The capsule, which could have been carried on the tip of an umbrella, contained a poison called ricin, a castor bean derivative that causes fever, vomiting, and finally massive blood clots throughout the body. In sufficient doses, it is invariably fatal. There is no specific treatment other than making the person comfortable, according to the U.S. Navy Bureau of Medicine and Surgery. There was also no pathological test for the presence of ricin, which left no identifiable trace in the bloodstream or body. Though the Bulgarian secret police were suspected in Markov's death, the murder remains unsolved. During his senior year, Swango took the Medical College Admission Test, MCAT, and applied to a number of medical schools. He graduated summa cum laude in 1979 and won the American Chemical Society's Award for Academic Excellence. Competition for admission to any accredited American medical school in the spring of 1979 was intense, as it had been ever since the baby boom generation began graduating from college in the late 60s and applying in droves to professional schools. This was the case not just at the country's most prodigious institutions, but also at newer, less well-known medical schools, such as Southern Illinois University. Demand for doctors was so strong that lucrative careers awaited medical school graduates. Huge numbers of applicants with good records were rejected from every medical schools to which they applied, and many migrated to medical schools in foreign countries. Huge numbers of applicants with good records were rejected from every medical school to which they applied, and many migrated to medical schools in foreign countries, Mexico being a common destination. Swango's classmate, Rosenthal, despite good grades in his science class at highly regarded Knox College and decent scores on the MCAT, had been rejected outright by 16 schools before securing a place on SIU's waiting list. Another of Swango's classmates had applied for 7 years in a row before she was accepted. Applicants to the U.S. medical schools were funneled through a centralized office in Washington, D.C., which sent preliminary applications to medical schools named by the applicant. If a medical school thought it might be interested, then, and only then, would it send a candidate its own application. Besides needing outstanding grades in a pre-med curriculum and high MCAT scores, applicants had to sit for a personal interview in which their maturity, commitment, and aptitude for medicine were evaluated. Because it was founded in part to improve medical services in Southern Illinois, SIU accepted only Illinois residents and looked for a commitment to a family practice in small town or rural Illinois. After a committee evaluated all the information candidates submitted, SIU, like other medical schools, placed them into one of three categories: reject, accept, or accept when place available. Muriel proudly reported to family members that Michael was accepted at several medical schools. Given his excellent academic record and test-taking ability, Swango would have been a strong candidate. His work in a hospital as an orderly would also have worked in his favor, and SIU would have been especially interested in someone like Swango, who was from Quincy, part of the area the medical school was meant to serve. Yet his classmates speculated that Swango had been admitted from the waiting list because he had moved into the dorms late, along with students who, like Rosenthal, had been admitted at the last minute. They surmised that Michael hadn't performed well in the admissions interview and wondered what he had answered when asked why he wanted to become a doctor. Among his classmates, the decision to become a doctor formed a large part of their getting acquainted conversations. Swango never participated in these conversations. He seemed blank when the topic surfaced. Swango never expressed any interest in patients. Still, apart from the cadaver incident, nearly everyone conceded that Swango seemed hardworking and disciplined. Some classmates were astounded to learn that he was working as a paramedic for America Ambulance in Springfield while a first-year student. Not only was outside employment during the first year frowned upon, Rosenthal had to get permission from the dean to teach a Sunday school class in Carbondale, but Swango was commuting to a city 100 miles away. And his violation of the anti-moonlighting policy was particularly brazen. For the Springfield hospitals, the ambulances served were affiliated with SIU and staffed with many SIU residents and professors. The staffers soon realized what Swango was doing, but no one on the faculty complained. He passed all 476 tests, however unorthodox his methods, in all of his courses, including anatomy. One member of the class had to repeat the first year, and one person flunked out. But when the rest of the class moved on to the second year in Springfield, Swango was among them. The central Illinois city of Springfield, with a population just over 100,000, seems a metropolis compared to Carbondale. It boasts the state capitol building and is steeped in the lore of its most famous resident, Abraham Lincoln, whose restored home is a major tourist attraction. The city is attractive to SIU because its two hospitals, St. John's and Memorial, are much larger than any in Carbondale. And it is there that SIU medical students gain their first clinical experience. Beginning with the second year, the medical school's curriculum turns away from basic science and anatomy to disease-oriented courses, including pharmacology, radiology, and pathology. Pathology, which includes toxicology, the study of poison, seemed particularly to fascinate Swango. It was taught by a popular professor, Dr. John Murphy, who was favorably impressed by him. During the third year of SIU's medical school, students undergo a series of rotations, including pediatrics, obstetrics and gynecology, internal medicine, and surgery. In the surgery rotations, students were assigned in pairs to give oral presentations. Rosenthal and Swango were partners, and at Rosenthal's suggestion, they chose to discuss the repair of certain defects through open-heart surgery. A relative of Rosenthal's was a heart surgeon and volunteered some original papers the students could use, but Rosenthal ended up having very little contact with his partner. This may have been because Swango was still working for the ambulance corps and frequently was either unavailable or fidgeting because he was going to be late for ambulance duty. But it was also because Rosenthal didn't like being around Swango. He was jumpy, nervous, and seemed unable to relax. He wore a beeper and would rush off whenever the ambulance service called. The pair ended up giving their presentation in two discrete sections, which might as well have been two separate reports. Swango had assembled several slides and gave a credible, if unmemorable, performance. But given that the topic was heart surgery, his subsequent performance in class was baffling. Swango's class assembled at the start of each day for what's called morning conference. One day, Dr. Roland Falls, the chairman of surgery, led a discussion of x-rays. He put a chest x-ray on a screen and pointed to a shadowy region in the middle of the image. He looked at the class, then focused on Swango. "Mike, tell us, what is in this picture?" he said. Swango was silent. Finally, he said, "I don't know." There was some titters from other students. That's the heart, Mike, Foles said sarcastically, emphasizing the word heart. It was almost as big a debacle as the cadaver incident. For any medical student this close to getting his degree should have been able to recognize the heart on an x-ray. It was so obvious that his classmates concluded that Swango must simply have panicked and frozen. Yet the episode was one of many that led some of his classmates to conclude that Swango was taking a surprisingly cavalier approach, not only to medical school, but to the well-being of his patients. One of the first clinical assignments medical students receive is to take histories and perform physicals, H&Ps, on hospital patients. Students interview patients, record their medical histories, undertake routine physical examinations, and post their results on the patient's charts. Depending on the patient, the procedure can take anywhere from half an hour to 90 minutes. His classmates observed that Swango was completing the entire rounds in less than an hour, sometimes spending what seemed like as little as 5 minutes with a patient. Yet he filed complete H&Ps. In at least one instance, another student charged that Swango had plagiarized or fabricated his entire write-up. The claim triggered renewed talks and concern about Swango among his classmates. Rosenthal and several others wondered whether Swango should be reported to the Student Progress Committee, a group of 12 faculty and 2 students that heard complaints of student misconduct, but no one did so. Within their third-year rotation, students can choose areas of specialization. There was a standing joke at SIU that the dumb and lazy chose anesthesia. The smart and lazy went into radiology. The dumb hard workers chose pediatrics, and the smart hard workers went into neurosurgery. Thus, it came as a surprise to many when Swango concentrated his courses in neurosurgery, especially considering the cadaver incident. Neurosurgery, involving delicate operations on the brain and other parts of the nervous system, is one of medicine's most demanding and highly paid specialties. It is emotionally taxing because patients needing neurosurgery are often in dire straits, and because deaths and catastrophic incidents on the operating table are probably more common than in any other area of practice. Still, competition for internships and residencies is intense. But Swango was no more forthcoming to his classmates about his choice of a specialty than he had been about why he had chosen medicine as a career. Swango's decision came as a particular shock to his classmate Sweeney, who had been so dismayed by the cadaver incident and thought Swango was ill-equipped to practice medicine at all, much less neurosurgery. Furthermore, neurosurgery happened to be Sweeney's area of concentration as well, so he and Swango would share patients and work closely together. The two were jointly assigned to a resident, Mark Swadoniak, who would oversee their work and act as a mentor. Though that meant Sweeney and Swango had to see each other virtually every day, they avoided each other as much as possible. Though most students sharing a neurosurgery specialty would observe each other's surgeries, Sweeney stayed away from Swango's. He was horrified by the prospect of what he might see, and Swango never showed up at Sweeney's either. So Wadniak, though he was genial and friendly, also developed an aversion to Swango. When Swango was out of earshot after one particularly frustrating encounter, so Wadniak turned to Sweeney and lamented, "What did I fucking do to deserve him?" But finally, in the person of a faculty neurosurgeon, Dr. Wyle Walkasser, Swango seemed to find a kindred spirit. Walkasser raved about Swango. He would brook no criticism of Swango's alleged haste, sloppy habits, or indifference to patient care. The two seemed all but inseparable. Swango eagerly accompanying the neurosurgeon on his rounds and into his surgeries. Indeed, Swango had persuaded the nursing staff to keep him on his ambulance pager whenever they learned that one of Wetcaser's patients was about to be admitted. That way, Swango was usually on the scene even before Wetcaser and sometimes before the patients themselves. This naturally froze Sweeney out of numerous opportunities for clinical experience, and it hardly endeared Swango to fellow students. The first-come, first-served system for assigning medical students to patients was subsequently changed. But naturally, Swango's eagerness made a favorable impression on Wetcaser, who found him remarkably pleasant and industrious. He thought Swango's patients' write-ups were close to perfect. Wetcaser was one of several Springfield doctors in private practice who also served as clinical instructors. He was popular among students and highly respected in his field, and the fact that he had championed Swango went a long way to ease students' concern about Swango's competence. He was also eccentric. Wetcaser drove around in a truck that had emblazoned on it the bold letters, Lyle Wetcaser, M.D., Neurosurgery and Light Hauling. Recently divorced and in his early 50s, Wetcaser would often invite students for post-surgery beers at his spacious office in a house across the street from the hospital, where he displayed the brain of a former patient in a jar of formaldehyde on the fireplace mantel. He also threw numerous parties. His office phone would be connected to the hospital's public address system. Wetcaser would get on the system and announce, "Fluid and electrolyte rounds in progress." The signal sent medical students flocking to the parties, which were often rowdy affairs where they could blow off steam. But Swango didn't drink alcohol, and despite his close relationship to Wetcaser, never attended the parties. Indeed, after Swango's surgery rotation ended, Wetcaser hardly ever saw him, and later realized that he knew nothing about Swango's background or personal life, even who his parents were or whether they were alive. During their third year at SIU Medical School, students have significantly more contact with patients and are responsible for hundreds of HNPs. In the course of the year, Swango's classmate, Rosenthal, noticed that Swango seemed unusually interested in, even preoccupied with, the sickest patients. The hospital maintained a large blackboard on which were written patient names and treatment remarks. When a patient Swango had seen died, he scrawled "died" in large capital letters across the patient's name. Rosenthal and other students found this distasteful, almost as though Swango was celebrating the demise and wanted to call attention to it. When Effie Walls, a kindly patient whom Rosenthal had met and whom Swango had been treated for an injury, died suddenly after a visit from Swango, he scrawled "died" over her name as well. Rosenthal went up to Swango and asked him why he did such a thing. "Don't you feel bad she died?" Swango gave Rosenthal a blank look. "No," he replied. "That's just what happens." It happened often with Swango. A standing joke among the students was that if they wanted to get rid of a patient, they should assign Swango to do an H&P. One day, Sawadniak mused to Sweeney that unusually often it seemed when he assigned Swango to do an H&P, the patient would suddenly code, meaning suffer a life-threatening emergency. Do you think it was just coincidence? But even as Sawadniak spoke, he dismissed the thought, and the two laughed it off. Swango was correct, after all, that death is a regular occurrence in a hospital. Sawadniak, Sweeney, and many of their classmates were developing a black sense of humor under the twin pressures of medical school and hospital life. After about five deaths in patients who seemed to be recovering satisfactorily, all of them soon after H&P by Swango, Sawadniak, Sweeney, and many of their classmates were developing a black sense of humor under the twin pressures of medical school and hospital life. After about 5 deaths in patients who seemed to be recovering satisfactorily, all of them soon after an H&P by Swango, Sawadniak coined a nickname for his seemingly disaster-prone protege, Double O Swango. Other medical students thought the nickname was hilarious, and soon it was in widespread use. Double O Swango meant license to kill.
I've got a better idea.
Thank God. All right. What is it, Mr. White? Lay it on me.
Beans.
Beans.
Castor beans.
So what are we going to do with them? Are we just going to grow a magic beanstalk? Huh? Climb it and escape?
We are going to process them into ricin.
Ricin beans.
Ricin. It's an extremely effective poison. It's toxic in small doses, also fairly easy to overlook during an autopsy.
All right, so...
Don't touch them.
Wait, seriously, you can get poison from beans.
Yes. Back in the late 70s, ricin was used to assassinate a Bulgarian journalist. The KGB modified the tip of an umbrella to inject a tiny pellet into the man's leg. And we're talking about an amount not much bigger than the head of a pin.
But it killed him?
Oh, yes. Now we just need to figure out a delivery device, and then no more Tuco.
Katherine Massey, Book Club, Context of White Supremacy, Audio Segment 1, James Stewart's Blind Eye. I meant to say at the beginning, not to be confused with the blind side. They have the definite article, the, at the top. This is just Blind Eye. All done with the first portion, we'll pick up on Chapter 2. Much obliged to Z's mommy for doing the narration. I've said for more than a decade, I hate doing the narrating for these books. It's very challenging for a book like this. Now, it is in English, but they got all of these wacky names. Different places, people who are natives from the continent. You gotta do all that. And then they even got all these other doctors' names. You gotta go and pronounce it like, ugh. And they got all of these medical terms. And man, yeah, that's, this I think would be close to black men in Brazilian soccer, where you got all that Portuguese and wacky names from a different continent. Would be another one where someone said, hey, Brother Gus, would you narrate? Because ostensibly, at first, I would think, oh, it's English and blah, 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 it's not too long, all that, but, uh-oh, wait a minute. What? They go to Zimbabwe? Yep, I'm good. The reason we had to borrow Mommy Z's vocals, there is an audiobook for Blind Eye. A listener was gracious enough to share it with me, but, there it is again, it's abridged, insert horror music, which is even curious because it's kind of rare for there to be an audiobook of a bestseller a well-known book. It's infrequent for that book, audiobook, to be shortened, abbreviated. In fact, the only other time that I can think of where this happened, President Obama, Dreams from My Father, and they omitted some of the most important, impactful portions where he talks about white supremacy, racism. We've only read like the preface, the prologue, and the first chapter. I can only imagine what type of content would be omitted from a book like this for the abridged audiobook. But that's why we had to borrow. We just cannot do abridged versions because, I mean, ooh, man, talk about deliberate omission. Anywho, number to dial if folks have observations. First segment, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. Got my Facebook privileges back. Thank you to the folks at Meta. Mark Zuckerberg was able to post and all that good stuff to promote for the program and catch up on messages and all that good stuff. But should be alerted for all the folks over there and Twitter, other social media apps. Share the broadcast. Let folks know that we are broadcasting and live with the Katherine Massey Book Club. Now, that's it. We'll read one email, then that folks who dialed in if they have thoughts, observations on the first portion of the reading as well. Let's see. okay. Email number one. Greetings, Gus. Excited to read this text. Very much in keeping with the theme of the last few reads, I was vaguely familiar with this creep back in the 1980s. Prologue one. Handsome American doctor had a syringe in his hand, Lutheran church in Zimbabwe. Like the new doctor, the minute they met him, Michael Swango looked like the American athletes Mpofu had seen on television. He was blonde and blue-eyed, taller than Mpofu. He knelt before the bishop. How often have we read about blonde hair and blue eyes in the book club? Many, many times. We are so conditioned in our response to it. Moreover, we are so often fooled by the tacky antics of suspected racists kneeling, feigning humility. Please. Let's see. I wonder, they say, keep saying American. I wonder if it would have been the same if it had been a Negro, but they were born in the U.S., same credentials, not a killer, though. But they're going to come around. I wonder if they would have been equally as, you know, awed about all of this. Maybe so. You know, he got an American, not blonde-haired, blue-eyed, but still American, seen his passport, came to work with us, help out fellow black brothers. Wow. Number two, most white people still return home for a lunch prepared by black servants. Man, we just heard this talking about South Africa to a white woman who is a South African native. Now, she was with us in Mexico at the time, but still, doctor. And in fact, she was disputing me about poor white people. It's not the same as being a Negro, not even close. And she said, dang, one of my students, grad students, just wrote a whole PhD project, thesis, I believe, on poor white people, put that in quotes, poor white people in South Africa, but they still got Negra servants. This is not South Africa, this is Zimbabwe, but still, southern part of the continent. They congregate at the Bulawayo Golf Club, the oldest club in Zimbabwe, with manicured fairways, and a swimming pool. White people still in charge. Even with a golf course and a swimming pool. Like, come on. Number, what? Number, come on, three. Mzezewa didn't know how much time passed while he lay there, alive and conscious, but paralyzed, terrified. I suspect he was given a paralytic muscle relaxant. Like Curare, drugs in this category are used in general anesthesia along with a sedative, narcotics, such as propofol, which was given to Michael Jackson, and the patient is intubated with a breathing tube on a ventilator since their breathing muscles are paralyzed. It is hard to put it into words, the utter horror of such a feeling. I'm sure that's what Mr. Swango was enjoying. You know, one thing that has kind of, they call him doctor, right? I mean, we have to pay attention to that. I don't know. Did he actually qualify for that? I mean, I have to pay attention to that. Is this dude like a doctor for real, for real? Not talking about the practicing part, but I mean, he even do everything necessary to like officially achieve that title? Chapter 1. Swango's military garb and fanatical devotion to fitness were noticed by just about everyone in his class at SIU Southern Illinois. Besides the military fatigues, he wore combat boots to class. I went to college with several former service men. During this time period, they often wore their hair short and had a certain bearing walk which stood out during the time period, but none of them had on army gear. The negativity of the Vietnam War was still on the minds of most young people. Number 2, that'll come up later. That didn't deter Swango, however, from using his notes during the exam. He would choose one of the tests, take it, then choose his next test topic, and sprint from the room back into the hallway. It wasn't expressly forbidden. This is a huge red flag, in my opinion. It should have made the medical school officials put this dude on close scrutiny. I wonder if they thought secretly he was just clever and outsmarted us, maybe even a little admiration. Whew, man. White people do lots of that, like, admiring the kind of mavericky, rebel white person, rule-breaker white person, that type of thing. 3. He unveiled his dissection. His fellow students gasped. He transformed the hip region of his cadaver into an unrecognizable mess of tangled flesh and bone. Another red flag that should have prompted some response from the dean of the medical school, maybe even a psychological evaluation given the previous red flags. 4. Millikan University, a small private liberal arts school in Decatur, Illinois. I have a relative who attended around the same time. No place is safe in the global system of racism, white supremacy. 5. On a form he submitted to the college's public information office, he falsely claimed that he had received both a Bronze Star for heroism in combat and a Purple Heart for combat wounds during his relatively brief tenure as a Marine. False claims of receiving these medals by white males mostly is so common it should trigger an immediate investigation for verification. It seems that many, many white people, they just don't... We've heard that so many times, Jeff Toobin and lots of these other folks who lie about lots of things, and looks like an honest white dude. We'll take him at his word. Like, that just seems to be like the par for the course for many, many things, many, many different scenarios. Number 6, applicants had to sit for a personal interview in which their maturity and commitment. During this time period, you could get accepted to accredited U.S. medical schools without an interview. Not sure if that's the case now. I seriously doubt it. Maybe on Zoom at the least. 7. Working as a paramedic for America Ambulance in Springfield while a first-year student, violation of the anti-moonlighting policy was particularly brazen. No one on the faculty complained. Why did they not put a stop to this? Oh, my bad. I forgot he's a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white man. See, that's what I mean. Like, the rules just, you know, whatever. It was a black doctor, McDuffie, black male in North Carolina. I spoke with him over the phone twice, and his quote was, 55 miles per hour means you, black boy. And it was this sort of thing explicitly. Like, there's no way, you know, I could even volunteer at the soup kitchen and they would be ready to throw me out of school if it was a black dude, but he's white, like he could be moonlighting and they see him going to work, like cutting class so he can go to work. Can't be late, got a shift this evening. Oh, right on. Hang in there. Rules don't apply. Number 8. Dr. Roland Fulce
chairman of surgery. He put a chest x-ray on the screen, pointed to a shadowy area in the middle of the image. Mike, tell us what's in this picture. Swango was silent. Finally, he said, I don't know. That's the heart, Mike. Again, no record of concern by the medical school professors. You have got to be kidding. No, they're not. Dill, man. He got accepted into University of Arizona, go Wildcats. His high school teachers, like, what? How? Are you sure? Okay. 10. Faculty neurosurgeon Dr. Lyle Wakasser. Swango seemed to find a kindred spirit. Wakasser raved about Swango. Wakasser drove around town in a truck that had emblazoned on it bold letters, Lyle Wakasser, M.D., neurosurgery and light hauling, displayed the brain of a former patient in a jar of formaldehyde on the fireplace mantel. He also threw numerous parties, the parties which were often rowdy affairs. I understand how they became kindred spirits, both exhibiting bizarre behavior. How in the heck did he get that brain? Now, really. Really. This is, what are we going to say, like 1980s? You literally just in the newspaper this week got major white institutions and museums saying, oh man, maybe we'll reconsider having all these bones, maybe Negro, but bones, out here on display. Maybe we'll pack up the bones. We don't need the human skeletons. Seems like a phrenology type of a thing. We talked about that this summer. John James Audubon digging up skulls for his homies to prove that the white brain was superior. So, no, it doesn't really surprise. Kendrick Johnson down in Georgia, they couldn't even find his innards. So, no, it does not surprise me at all that particularly a white doctor, no, he's not going to have difficulty getting his hands on a brain at all. In fact, it could have been passed down for generations. Let's see. I guess the surgery he performed did not work out so well. Rowdy parties with students is so incorrect. Dr. Wakasser died at the age of 87 in 2020. Now, talk about life expectancy. Swango seemed unusually interested in, even preoccupied with, the sickest patients. When a patient Swango had seen died, he scrawled "died" in large capital letters across the person's name. What can be described as gallows humor and language is a common amongst people in the medical profession, particularly medical students and residents, but this is, to me, a step beyond that. An interesting book which describes some of this language as the novel is the novel House of God by Samuel Shem. And we'll stop there. This will come up again in the second portion of the audio, so-called gallows humor. And we've heard this before. Even Sue Klebo talked about this, but we'll revisit. All right, we'll pause there since he has more notes, but we haven't got that far yet. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943. Pound, press star 61 if you would like to participate. Much obliged to Z's mommy for doing the heavy lifting of reading. I definitely enjoying the text, but I probably would enjoy it a little less if I had to do all of the challenging pronunciation and all these wacky medical terms and such. It would probably be a lot less fun. So much obliged for doing the narration for us. Hopefully listeners, myself as well, grateful. So this book, even one question, why do we think Mr. Stewart, white man, award-winning white author, lawyer, why do we think he starts this book, Kaneas Mazezwa, his attempted murder, we'll say. I don't know if he lives or dies. We'll have to see. But why do we think he starts here? there are lots of different, you know, points along the Swango tale, lots of different murders and what have you, that he could have kicked this book off with. Why does he start us off in Zimbabwe, other side of the world, with this particular murder? I mean, literally, the first paragraph of the book is a white doctor sticking a needle in the buttocks of an African. I mean, dang, that is, what is going on? So that's one, because that's not how the Unsolved Mysteries segment starts. Let's see. We already had the blue-eyed blonde hair, which seems to come up repeatedly, and we've only really read one chapter and preface, basically. As I said, so this is the fourth book in a row. The prestigious Ohio State University. Now, Swango wasn't a student there, but doing an internship at OSU, or working there, rather, that still qualifies. You're affiliated. Buckeyes, go. Let's see. Still looking through my own notes from the preface. Says, before Swango, the only European or American doctors the church had succeeded in bringing to Zimbabwe were evangelical Lutherans from church headquarters in Sweden, and none of them stayed more than a few years. Dang. It's like the highfalutin white people don't really want to be in this part of the world, kind of the outskirts, and lots of white people left and what have you. And then, because they start in this part of the world, the book can start off immediately with all of this history of colonialism in Zimbabwe. You even a white supremacist regime of Ian Smith. Like, what? We got to get into all that immediate. This is basically like page two of the book. Like, dang, did I sign up? I thought we were reading about the serial killer doctor. Now we got to get a history lesson on white supremacy and colonialism in Zimbabwe? Where is that at even? Robert Mugabe? Like, what is going on? Ian Smith? Dang. Mercurial Robert Mugabe. I always pay attention to what adjectives white people use when they describe Robert Mugabe. I think he just passed away not too long ago, and they had lots of curious ways of describing him then as well. Let's see, and the controversial pronouncements like denouncing homosexuals as perverts who are worse than dogs and pigs. There are many areas of the world that have the same view. They do not support the anti-sex so-called homosexual activity. That even came up this week. Hear about that on the compensatory call-in. The sentence he says, since independence, whatever that means, Zimbabwe had the collapse of its currency, a steep decline in its standard of living, and the emigration with an E of much of its white population. I think those last three might be related because they are not independent. Individuals classified as white still dominate what happens in that part of the world. So, yeah. We don't like what you all are doing here. You decide that you're going to get rowdy. Well, fine. We will say that your currency is worth peanuts, and you all will be living in squalor, and we'll be over here kicking it at the golf course, swimming. How you like them apples? Peanuts. In fact, can't afford apples. Let's see. They say a debilitating civil war between the two ethnic groups broke out almost immediately after Zimbabwe gained independence, and though a truce was reached, simmering tensions persist. That's the sort of thing where I say usual suspects, particularly knowing individuals classified as white the way that I do. Oh yeah, usual suspects. I've seen this in Rwanda, many other parts of the world where they will play one group of non-white people against the other and just keep conflict going, for any sort of reason. They speak different than you, or they look different than you, or they said something about your mama, or you remember what your grandparents, y'all had that feud way back 50 years ago, that type of, yeah. Let's see. They say that, see what I just did, the white people left, right? Low cost of, or low quality of living. Currency is devalued. It's filth and nothing. Meanwhile, many people in Balawayo seem to prefer the atmosphere of faded gentility, especially the 50,000 or so remaining whites, most of British descent. These days, few live lavishly. There's little conspicuous wealth, but they praise the city's unhurried pace. Skipping a few sentences, most white people still return home for a lunch prepared by black servants. They congregate to the golf club. And an imposing, all of this overlooks the imposing Beaux-Arts Mansion downtown. And then they got the settlements with thousands of black people crowded into a small house of shanties and all that. That's what we heard about South Africa. Really, they could be talking about New Orleans or Baltimore or wherever else. Rio, talking about Brazil, talking about wherever. We've heard this over and over and over. Global system. But again, dang, that is an auspicious prologue for a book that is not about Africa, ostensibly, or racism, ostensibly. Or is it? Let's see. Swango gets there, stays at the colonial era hotel, whatever that means. Let's see. It's a drought, and malaria are constant threats, in part because the lower elevation makes the climate more tropical than it is on the high plateau where most of the white population lives. I thought they were independent. I thought the colonial rule was over. They didn't go up there. Robert Mugabe, he didn't go up there with swords and an army and tanks and, you know, or at least the big loudspeakers. Hey, look here. You all are out of here. You know, we're done. We're done with all that. We're going to take the high land and you all can, you know, I don't know. You do what you got to do. You go to the low land or you'll figure it out. You know, that didn't happen. Let's say, let's see. Zishiri. I'm not sure that's how you say it. Z-S-H-I-R-I. Zishiri and Swango soon became friends. What I say about that music. Dun, dun, dun. Like, come on. That's another one. Who is informed about racism? A white man you don't know from the other side of the world comes here. You're not suspicious. Who is this dude? Why did you come all the way out here? We've seen your kind before. Hey, this is a cool... This Mike dude is the... Victims. We are victims. They say, now, Swango was always eager for conversation and filled with curiosity. That does not surprise me at all about someone classified as white. I'm just soaking up information. I'm studying. Y'all do what? This is over here. Oh, wow. You can show me all that. Where do you keep the poisons at? Oh, wow. Okay. Learn all that. And what's the combination? Okay. Cura, just tell me about everything. I'm just, what they say, the sponge. I'm just soaking it up. I get to hang out. They say he wouldn't even sleep. Indefatigable. I believe it. Absolutely. You give me about 6 months. Wee. I'm going to get that car. I will be running the entire village. I'll be able to kill everybody here. I've seen that before. What does it mean to be white? Let's see. And they end the prologue with it. Hey, you must have been delirious. You know, we got these crazy niggers. We don't even know how all that ends. I said, we don't know if he dies. Mzezwe, does he die? Is he alive? What happens? Do they save his life, you know? Cliffhanger. Okay, so then we actually get to chapter one. This reminded me when they talk about Swango, he's in all his military gear and his boots and everything when he's in college. And this kind of stood out for the time because people were kind of against the Vietnam War. This is still pretty close to that in the 70s. Mr. Fuller, he said some years ago, he was talking about jogging and all that, and he said people weren't really doing all of this, like fitness crazy stuff that you have now and got to be counting carbs and all that. He said people weren't doing all of that then. He said that was kind of a newer thing around this time period. And he even pegged like a movie like Rocky and other things that kind of to work specifically targeting white people and saying we're getting lazy and not really being on our assignment. Let's get up and get out there and, you know, be a little bit more fit, more active, sitting around gaining all this weight. Obviously, enough people didn't listen. Let's see. Chapter 1. Swango bridled at their ribbing and increasingly kept to himself. They teased him about his clothes and stuff. Said, oh, man, I've heard this before. This reminds me of old Dill. Oh, Reb. Oh, man, he was teased. He didn't have friends. So he had to go blow up the whole school. Let's see. The obstetrics and gynecology. Keep that in mind. OBGYNs, keep that in mind. Talking about the protocol when you get into this medical career. The swangoing. This, again, this seems like one, you know, hey, are we in charge at the school? Do you have deans, professors, you have people who are supposed to, hey, they could just say, no swangoing. You're going to take the exam, you stay in, we're taking all the exams, we're not running out to go in 5 minutes of looking over and all that. Once you step in the room, we're done. I mean, they could, you know, make the rules and all of that other stuff. They can't do that? I don't understand. Let's see. Let's see. They talked about after he messed up the cadaver, which did remind me a little Jeffrey Dahmer, but after he messed that up and some of the students had the option of going to report them, report their concerns themselves, say, hey, maybe we need to watch. This is kind of serious. You're going to be a doctor. You'll be in charge of people's health. Maybe you should evaluate this guy. And they didn't even do that. There's so many moments, and we just started this book. There's so many moments where I thought, wow, if this were someone classified as not white, whew, we would have never got this. For, like, this would have been nipped in the bud. Even the Zimbabwe part, like, I don't know if it would have been so. I could be totally wrong. I'm not disparaging anyone on the continent. I don't know if anyone has done any of these programs, if you're a physician or what have you, and you went to the continent and they were overwhelmed, like, thank God, we thought you were going to be one of those blonde, blue-eyed crackers from the U.S. or Britain or Australia or wherever, and oh my God, we have, you know, had it up to our eyeballs with whitey. Thank God that you came, brother. If that was your experience, then let ignorant Gus know, and I will stand checked and corrected. Ask for, you know, forgive me for saying wrong, but I don't know. Like, we did read President Obama's memoir. He did talk about that going back to the motherland, to Kenya, and he gave that restaurant scene where he talked in detail, like, dang, they hooked these white people up, went back and gave them extra cool water and extra ice cubes. We had to beg and shout and scream, dang, I'm Kenyan. I'm going to be president. What's wrong with you? I'm saying he could have lied. And people say Obama tricked us a bunch, so he could have, you know, maybe he tricked us. Wrote that a long time ago. Maybe things changed. Anyway, let's see. He went to the Catholic Boys High School in Quincy, Illinois. I paused to look. Quincy, Illinois is about 88% white. That is kind of sundown town, racially restricted region range. I don't even know what it was, you know, way back 30 years ago. It could have been worse. Yikes. The Catholic Church in Illinois is well documented, well indicted for the same sexual abuse that we've heard about over and over and over. Illinois rife with all of this, and Quincy specifically with sexual abuse within the Catholic Church. I was trying to look specifically to see if Christian brothers in Quincy, Illinois, if there are any reports of sexual abuse there. Quincy College, absolutely. They have repeat pages. They have a whole report on sexual abuse in Illinois, and there's Quincy College comes up over and over for numbers of white males working there who accused of sexually abusing people where this went on. unfettered for decades. No surprise, we've heard all that before. Let's see. His interest in the Holocaust reminded me, we've heard this before. Old Reb Dill loved them some Nazi Germany and write papers about it and all. Let's see. We got 1972 yearbook picture shows Michael in his band uniform smiling with tousled blonde hair. Again, we heard all that about hair in The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. None of it was this way about, oh, that hair. Oh, wow. This is a really cool dude. Did you see that hair? No, it was, the hair had to be beaten and whipped and tamed and covered and degraded. Kinky. He was valedictorian. Shame on you, non-Clemson dad. He was fascinated by guns. Now, I have heard that mentioned as one of those that, ooh, that can be red flag for these school shooters and people, you know, you might have to keep an eye on them. But, I mean, dang, that is white culture. Fascination with, obsession with firearms. Let's see. We got all this about ricin poison with, man, do white people, they just sit around and study poison and, oh, infamous murderers and get all this knowledge and I'm going to be super smart and get my 3.89 grade point average and study science and chemistry and biology and, oh, all that for what? Oh, now I know how to make ricin. I get these castor beans. Took that scene from Breaking Bad. Ricin features prominently, and that was Walter White, scientist, talking about the ricin poison. Make this from the beans. We'll go out and poison Tuco, who's a non-white person. They even go to poison non-white children with ricin there and all that. But that's what you do with all this knowledge and information. Figure out ways to kill people. Yes. New and creative ways to kill people that they won't even know how we killed them. Let's see. So he's having all of these problems through med school. He can't recognize a heart. I was even thinking that's when, you know, you got a good chance just guess. Like, they tell you it's the chest, like, can't be an Achilles, I know that, and it's not the pelvis, so I'ma just guess. The heart seems like, at least it's in the right region, I'ma say heart, you know. I tell him, it looked like you got the ball there, oh, okay, it's not bad. I thought you tried to slip on slippery questions, I got you, I'm with you, okay, that's, what do you mean, I don't know, man, you've been sitting here this long, come on. Let's see. So they don't report him, which I'd said before. They had the opportunity. If he had been a black person and he's making these sort of errors in class, everyone would have reported him. He'd have probably gotten the boot, man. Just from the chainsaw incident alone, he would have got the boot. Let me see. Dr. Lyle Wakasser, he's got the brain in the jar and all that kindred spirit. He's throwing all these wacky parties. That right there, I bet that would be the sort of thing where you got all these folks. How do white people get all this access to Percocets and everything? How do we get all this? That right there, I'd say, would be one, probably two ways, because it'd be people like that where you have these rowdy parties. Now, we're not going to just have a rowdy party with liquor. That's not rowdy enough. Like, you're a doctor. You got the brain in the jar, man. Get the Percocets, man. Get the Adderall, man. What's up? That's one. And then your patients, who are your homies at these rowdy parties, after you get them hooked, now they come in, hey, man, I need my script filled, man. Get me the perks, man. Come on. Maybe I'm, you know, talking crazy. Let's see. And the 007, we got that. Now, even that right there. How you get a nickname? 00 Swango. What, I mean, that's, you think so if it had been Dr. Welsing? Mysterious deaths, they go put her over to talk to some patients, and she'd been talking all wacky about white genetic annihilation and suntanning. You think they put Dr. Welsing over there and they nickname her double O Welsing. Say, this old Welsing witch, she comes around and patients die. You think we ought to say something? Nah, we'll just keep an eye on her, old double O Welsing. Yeah, we'll just keep an eye. Like, are you serious? Are you serious? Let's see. Folks who dialed in with a hand up. Non-Clemson dad, Mama C. Woke baby. Should be with us.
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, I read this some time ago, but I have some great notes. First, probably some of this stuff was mentioned, but I wasn't able to listen to everything. It said his fellow classmates had no idea why Swango wanted to become a doctor. I said, typically, like, if you're a pre-med student, you'll be talking with your classmates about your fascination with medicine and what kind of inspires you to want to pursue medicine. And Swango never indulged in these types of conversations. So a common theme throughout the book will be, what is his motivation? Typically, people want to become a doctor to heal disease or treat disease. But the question here is, did Swango want to create disease? In the beginning, one moment. In the beginning, before the book even starts, it says some of the praise for Blindside. If Swango is guilty, he must share responsibility with the medical establishment that let him move freely from state to state, from hospital to hospital without warning or punishment. And what I got from that was, this will probably be the case with this baby killer woman. You know, they're gonna try to absolve her of some of the blame. And same for Swango, like, oh, it wasn't all his fault. The medical staff at the schools or at the hospital are also complicit in this. So there's mixed feelings about that. But with that, I'll share some of my notes on the second commentary.
Much obliged, Mama C. With the Lucy Letby, that's who she's talking about, Lucy Letby, the white woman across the pond in Britain. She was just convicted for killing babies. It is very, very similar. That's why I was saying the timing, as opposed to if we had read this book a year and a half ago, waiting and reading it now, I didn't know about that case. She hadn't been prosecuted, hadn't been convicted at that time. So waiting and to do all of this now, some of the exact same themes in terms of where people did raise suspicions, ask questions. They did think she was up to no good, and they were told, even a non-white doctor, and they were told to hush it up, keep it quiet, wasn't criminally prosecuted, and this just was allowed to continue and go on. Another blonde, blue-eyed white person, this time a female, and this just was allowed to continue. Have to see. That's why I said, like, oh man, it's so much more relevant now than when we start. And the same thing, this is not just one person, not one white person's guilt. This is a whole lot of white people. Why didn't the other doctors ask more questions? You got these suspicious deaths. Come on, man. And now you got cameras and such. Come on, man. She's got those blue eyes. She couldn't have done that. He's got that blonde hair. Mike wouldn't have done that. Oh, double O Swang. I wonder what kind of nickname she had. Anywho, let's see. There's so many reports on this. Quincy, they have a news herald. I think it's the Quincy Whig Herald, or maybe inverted Herald Whig, but either or. They have archives of their newspaper, still in existence, but in terms of the archives, they go back and they covered the Swango case from like the 80s all the way through when he was convicted in the 90s. If you want to go and check research as we are reading this book, it is just fascinating to look at the trail of paperwork that was, as they said in the Unsolved Mysteries report, a folder an inch thick. Yeah. Don't even bother to check. What does it mean to be white? The great Harriet A. Washington, after her article from the New York Times, where she talks about why Africa fears Western medicine, and I crossed out Western and put white. That report is from 2007. She mentions Michael Swango in that article. I have to read the paragraph where she talks about him in addition to other white so-called doctors and healthcare practitioners who did the exact same thing, lied, and you're supposed to be helping and healing, and they go to harm, terrorize, kill black people. The great Harriet A. Washington, loved medical apartheid in my top 10, but check out that review. I think I shared it on social media. Got my Facebook and all back, so I shared it there, but love that report. And Michael Swango mentioned right there why Africa fears white medicine. In fact, I was thinking the whole time, Michael Swango should have been mentioned frequently the whole time. They were talking about people being fearful of the vaccine and all that, distrustful of the medical establishment. Like, dang, maybe they saw that recent documentary on Michael Swango or Red Blonde Eye. I can see, ooh, might be a little bit hesitant. Like, y'all don't even check amongst your own. You let that guy do all that? Like, yeah, we did. Anywho, we will get to the second audio installment. If you did not get to share, take notes. We will have ample time once the second clip concludes. I guess you can be pondering, why do we think James Stewart started in Zimbabwe? Like, that is part of the story. I mean, you know, for real. But why start there? We'll keep that in mind as we proceed. Audio segment number two, James Stewart, Blind Eye, the Katherine Massey Book Club.
Chapter 2. During Swango's last year of medical school, in January 1982, his mother called him and his brothers, Richard, Bob, and John, with the news that their father was dying and that they should return home to Quincy as soon as possible. Michael drove from Springfield. Richard, Virgil's stepson, made the trip from Florida, where he was working as a certified public accountant, and Bob flew back from Eugene, Oregon, where he was an orderly at a nursing home. John, the youngest, stayed at his Air Force base in Italy. But Muriel's call to her son had come too late. Virgil died on January 29th at Quincy's Blessing Hospital before the family had converged. Colonel Swango was giving a 21-gun salute, and was buried with full military honors in a brief graveside service attended by a handful of family members and friends. At his request, there had been no visitation or memorial service at the funeral home either. Michael was the center of attention, clean-cut, neatly dressed in a blazer and tie, easily the most handsome of the colonel's sons, along with his girlfriend, an attractive brunette. He was at his mother's side through the ceremony. None of the sons spoke. Muriel sat rigidly, saying nothing and showing no emotion at her husband's death. But she seemed to glow with pride afterward as relatives congratulated Michael on his progress in medical school, his work as a paramedic, and his seemingly bright future as a doctor. Muriel had always favored Michael over the other boys, and she did so now, too. The attention galled Bob, who had long, unkept hair, had never graduated from college, and still looked like a hippie. At the funeral, people kept referring to him as Mike's brother. He hadn't spoken to Mike in years, but he thought his brother's poise, his charm, and his earnest young professional demeanor were an elaborate charade. The military hero's farewell accorded Virgil glossed over the reality that the Swango family had, for all practical purposes, disintegrated. Virgil had died from cirrhosis of the liver, lonely, living in a mobile home, his Vietnam exploits long forgotten. He and Muriel, though never divorced, had legally separated. She had no contact with him since he left the family home in 1976 following a prolonged bout of heavy drinking and an altercation in which he struck her. Muriel had said that she wouldn't tolerate physical abuse, and she insisted that he move out. Though she was in touch with his doctors, she did not visit or speak to her husband during his final days in the hospital. Like many Vietnam veterans, Virgil Swango had had a difficult time adapting to civilian life. He went to work in Quincy as a real estate agent for Richard Hap Northern, an old family friend, but his sales and commissions were meager. His father, John Harvey Swango, had been a prominent Democrat and served as Adam County Recorder of Deeds for 28 years, a remarkably long tenure for an elected position. Confident that he would have high name recognition and would be greeted by voters as a war hero, Virgil tried to pursue a political career running as a Democrat for a post as county supervisor. The campaign was his first indication that Vietnam veterans were viewed not as heroes, but as losers, as he later put it. He was painfully disappointed when he came in last in a four-man race. With his political hopes dashed, Virgil immersed himself in patriotic and veterans organizations, the American Legion, the Veterans of Foreign Affairs, and the Reserve Officers Association, and made the rounds of Quincy's many neighborhood taverns. When he was cited for valor by the State Department in 1976, he commented bitterly to the Quincy Herald Whig that Vietnam is old hat now. Everybody's forgotten about it. The same article mentioned Virgil's pride in his son. Michael, at 21, following in his father's footsteps with the military as a sergeant with the Marine Corps. It is ironic that in his last years, Virgil looked to Michael as a source of paternal pride, for he had almost no contact with him or his other sons, and had had only sporadic involvement with them as children. The family moved 16 times in the course of Virgil's military career, from Washington State to Fort Benning, Georgia, to Fort Worth, Texas, to San Francisco. From 1968 to 1975, the stretch when Virgil served in Vietnam, the family lived in Quincy, where Michael entered junior high school. Virgil visited once every 6 months, and they seemed only too eager to return to South Asia. A photo from his time in Vietnam shows him relaxed and smiling, sunbathing, on a web lounge chair outside his trailer with a drink in hand. When he did spend time with the family, he ruled with military precision. When the boys were young and the family was living at Fort Benning, he trained them to march in formation, salute, and execute military commands. Whenever visitors came to the spacious house reserved for the family because of John Virgil's rank as an officer, he put the boys through their paces, then dismissed them. He also enforced a disciplinary code derived from the military principle that an officer is responsible for the conduct of those he commands. In the Swango household, this meant that the oldest child was responsible for his younger brothers. So Bob was punished whenever Michael or John misbehaved. Dick, Muriel's older son from her previous marriage, had left to live with his father, in part to escape the rigors of life with Virgil. But the actual punishment was usually delegated to Muriel, except on a few occasions, such as the time Bob stole $10 from his father, or when he referred to an officer named Maloney as Baloney. When Virgil whipped Bob with a belt, Michael, on the other hand, was never subjected to corporal punishment, nor was John. Still, all the boys were afraid of their father. Muriel herself had little stomach for discipline, which tended to flag whenever Virgil was away. One day at Fort Benning, the boys returned home to find her sobbing, slumped over the kitchen table. It was the first time any of them had seen her cry. When they asked her what was wrong, she explained that a colonel who lived next door had berated her for letting her children run wild. The boys rode their bikes and roamed the neighborhood unsupervised. And while watching professional wrestling on TV, Bob and Mike often wrestled too, which sometimes threatened to get out of hand. But the boys were no more unruly than most children their age. And despite the neighbor's criticism, Muriel seemed determined to be a good mother. She read to the children, helped with their homework, created math problems for them. She belonged to the Book of the Month Club and was always giving them books. She especially loved mysteries and true crime thrillers. Muriel did her best to maintain a routine of family values. Thanks to Virgil's military salary and the low cost of living, the family was well provided for, and the boys were clean and neatly dressed. At the same time, Muriel was oddly distant emotionally. Virgil's sister Louise Sharp and her husband lived with the Swangles for a while in Quincy, and later visited them at Fort Benning. They rarely saw Muriel kiss or hug any of the boys or display any other affection towards them, nor did they ever see her cry. When Virgil's handsome, popular, much younger brother Robert died, suddenly of kidney failure at age 24, emotionally devastated, the Swangle family, Muriel shed no tears at the funeral, even though she had been close to her brother-in-law. She named Michael's older brother Bob after him. Louise had worked in Quincy as a waitress at the Dugout, a popular restaurant where Muriel and her first husband, Richard Kirking, often went out for dinner. Muriel struck Louise as very reserved and formal in her demeanor. At Christmas, none of the boys' presents were ever wrapped. Muriel simply put them in paper bags when she stapled shut. When the boys clamored for a pet, Muriel said no, citing their father's allergic reaction to animal hair. But their children never saw any evidence of such allergies. When Michael was in first grade, the boys were given a rabbit for Easter. It lived in a chicken wire cage behind the house for 2 weeks until a neighbor's dog got into a cage and ate it. The Swango clan, most of them gregarious and affectionate by nature, generally found Muriel and Virgil's home cold and inhospitable, but they chalked it up to Muriel's upbringing. Muriel's father, John Strubhart, was a barber in Teeny Breeze, Illinois, due east of St. Louis. Of German background, he was a strict disciplinarian, who maintained a stereotypically Teutonic distance from Muriel and her sister. In Muriel's failed first marriage to Richard Kirking, who turned out to be a heavy drinker, had done nothing to bolster any inclination toward warmth or intimacy. Virgil met Muriel near the end of World War II, when he was home on leave. She was recently divorced and working at the office manager for the Swangle family physician. A slender, attractive brunette, she had been raised a Catholic, but never attended church or said much about religion. Virgil was tall, handsome, solidly built, sociable, and had worked for his father in the Recorder of Deeds office before joining the army. At the end of the war, Virgil, who held the rank of captain and was serving in Korea, was among the American signatories to the Japanese surrender. He had been married twice before, both times briefly, and had a daughter from his previous marriage. He wrote his second wife from Korea to tell her he wanted a divorce. She was devastated by the unexpected news. He had another girlfriend at the time, but after meeting Muriel, he courted her assiduously. They were married in 1947. A few years later, he returned to Korea. Virgil was away when Bob was born in 1950, and Muriel moved back to Greece to live with her parents until her husband returned in 1953. The family moved to Fort Lewis in Tacoma, Washington, where Michael was born in 1954, and then to Fort Richardson near Anchorage, Alaska, where John was born. Snapshots from Alaska show an apparently happy, laughing, young family in a snowy landscape with Bob and Michael on a miniature skis. After 3 years there, Virgil was transferred to Fort Benning. In later years, Muriel and Virgil never said anything about their romance and courtship or early years together. Bob sometimes compared his parents to the Prim Ward and June Cleaver on Leave It to Beaver, a television show the family watched. Muriel and Virgil slept in twin beds, and there were no signs of physical affection between them. Not even the boys ever saw them kiss or trade affectionate hugs. Still, they always assumed their parents were happily married. The only mention of sex came when Bob was in eighth grade. Virgil took him aside and in serious tones told him it was time to teach you the bloodlines. Though Bob waited expectantly, that was all his father ever had to say on the subject. Despite living in a far-flung military outpost, the Swangos stayed in touch with their families in Breeze and Quincy. Although the boys pleaded for trips to Disneyland or National Park, visits to relatives constituted the family's only vacations. Until Virgil left for Vietnam, every summer he loaded the family and their luggage into a station wagon, and they set out for visits to their grandparents. The boys were lodged in the rear of the unair-conditioned car for what seemed like unending treks across the sweltering southern or plain states. Their parents sat in the front seat, chain-smoking. Virgil ran the expeditions like military maneuvers, barking orders at the boys, rejecting pleas to visit tourist attractions along the route, or to make brief stops, even to use a restroom. They stopped only when he deemed it appropriate. On these stops, he referred to Muriel as the navigator. When Virgil returned from Vietnam in 1963, after his first tour there, he was assigned to teach military science in the ROTC program at Texas Christian University in Fort Worth, and the family moved to Texas. But Virgil, plainly chafing at his classroom assignment, eagerly volunteered to return to Vietnam less than a year later. The family moved back to Quincy. Then in 1966, Virgil was transferred from Vietnam to San Francisco, where the family lived at the Presidio. After nearly 26 years, his army career was winding down, and it was clear he would soon be retiring with a generous pension. But he made little pretense of any interest in the family. Even though he was now back in the United States with a routine desk job, he was out late almost every night, and Muriel and the boys rarely saw him. One evening, Bob, Michael, and John were watching TV and doing their homework when their father returned. They heard their mother confront him. "Why are you never home?" she angrily demanded. Some kind of argument ensued, with shouting that left Muriel in tears. Virgil stormed out of the house. The boys were shocked. This was only the second time they had ever heard their mother weep, and they had never seen her openly angry at their father. They thought maybe their parents would divorce, but nothing more was ever said. And in September 1967, after Virgil was promoted to full colonel and almost immediately announced his retirement, the family returned to Quincy. They moved to a spacious new-style ranch brick house on Maple Street. Michael entered the seventh grade at Quincy Junior High School. Virgil talked vaguely about entering politics, but he had barely settled in when he joined the U.S. Agency for International Development, AID, and studied briefly at the Foreign Service Institute in Washington, D.C. He flew to Vietnam, arriving in Saigon on December 30th, 1967, just in time for the Tet Offensive, beginning January 30th, 1968. On February 1st, 1968, Nguyen Ngoc Long, a Vietnamese national police commander, executed a Viet Cong insurgent in downtown Saigon in full view of an NBC crew, an AP photographer, and some American officials. The resulting photograph won a Pulitzer Prize and became one of the most enduring images of the war. Shows Nguyen holding a pistol inches from the head of the prisoner, who stands with his hands tied behind his back. Virgil Swango kept a copy of the photograph for the rest of his life and made a point of showing it to Michael. He may have witnessed the execution, since he was in Saigon at the time. After a few weeks in Saigon, Swango was assigned to the Gokong province as a senior advisor to courts, or Civil Operations and Revolutionary Development Support. Gokong province, located in the Mekong Delta south of Saigon, is often cited as one of the few successful U.S. efforts at pacification of the Vietnamese countryside. The fertile rice-growing area experienced relatively few combat operations. A photograph from the period shows Colonel Swango escorting visiting American Defense Secretary Melvin Laird. In another snapshot, he is with South Vietnamese President Nguyen Van Thieu. Swango was also close to the American military advisor John Paul Van, the subject of Neil Shahan's Pulitzer Prize-winning book, A Bright Shining Line. The two had fought together at the pivotal Battle of Ap Pak in 1963, a significant early defeat for the American and South Vietnamese forces. In 1970, Van shifted Swango to Cha Dak province, noting that since Gokong had been successfully pacified, Swango must be bored. While the full history of AID's involvement in Vietnam remains murky, the Corps' operation embraced both military and civilian operations. During Swango's tenure, Corps was staffed in part by CIA agents, many with military backgrounds. The CIA also ran the Phoenix Program, a pacification project that overlapped and sometimes merged with Corps' operation until 1969, when responsibility for Phoenix was transferred to the military. The Phoenix Program gained notoriety for torturing and executing suspected Viet Cong agents operating in the South. Bob and Michael later told others that their father was in the CIA and served in the Phoenix Program, murdering and burning villages, as anti-war Bob described it. But while Shirley would have known the extent of CIA activity and counterinsurgency operations in his region, there is nothing to suggest that Virgil was directly involved. On the contrary, his colleagues and friends in Vietnam at the time say that Swango was a bona fide AID official who oversaw agriculture and civilian development projects and believed passionately in the American cause. In 1972, Virgil Swango prepared a lengthy report on his activities in Vietnam, which is relentlessly optimistic and, with benefit of hindsight, almost touchingly naive. While free world military forces battle the enemy with guns and grenades, he wrote, there was an equally vital, if less publicized, battle underway. No less than 40 nations of the free world are involved in this battle, the struggle against hunger, poverty, ignorance, and fear. Each success in this field makes the enemy's appeal weaker. It makes the job of the fighting man easier. To his colleagues in Vietnam, Virgil made no mention of a family in Quincy. He lived in a mobile home decorated with knickknacks he picked up during vacations in Southeast Asia. One plaque quoted the chronically inebriated W.C. Fields. Water? Who drinks water? Fish fuck in it. There was no family photographs. Virgil drank heavily and liked to socialize with colleagues. They knew he had been married more than once, but not that he still had a wife or children. Perhaps the reason for his silence was that he was living with a Vietnamese woman. According to a member in Quincy, in whom he confided, he had fallen in love. He made brief sporadic visits to Muriel and the boys only out of a sense of duty. After he was featured on NBC Nightly News in 1972, the Herald Whig ran a brief article about his being on TV. Interviewed by the paper, Muriel said she hadn't known he was going to be on television and hadn't seen the program. Back in Quincy, there was almost a sense of relief among his sons that Virgil had returned to Vietnam for what seemed an indefinite stay. Since the incident at the Presidio, relations between husband and wife had been even cooler than usual. On his visits home, he seemed restless and eager to learn. He told his wife and sons little about his life or activities in Vietnam. He maintained that disclosing in details of his work, even to his family, would be a breach of security. But his reticence may have fostered the boy's speculation that he was engaged in violent CIA-directed exploits. As the boys grew older and more independent, they increasingly resented their father's military strictures. Once they moved back to Quincy, the semblance of a family life steadily eroded. Muriel gave up on a family meal, preparing to spend her evenings bowling or playing bridge with friends. Two activities she pursued avidly. She left a supply of TV dinners in the freezer, and the boys simply heated their own meals whenever they wanted, almost never sitting down together. One Thanksgiving, she baked a turkey and made rolls, but then seemed to give up, for there was nothing else on the table. When Muriel was home, she spent her time with Michael, listening to him play the piano or clarinet, typing his homework or discussing the mysteries and thrillers that she loved and that he had begun to read almost as avidly. As early as the sixth grade, Michael had been a reader of true crime magazines and comics books, as had Bob. But Bob soon moved on to science fiction, whereas Michael began buying copies of the National Enquirer, scanning its pages for sensational crime stories. He clipped some of the articles, and Muriel helped him assemble them into scrapbooks. Bob and John began to feel left out. Whatever love their mother could muster for her children seemed to be allocated disproportionately to Michael. Only he received the music lessons, the expensive clarinet, the private school education. But not even Michael received motherly hugs or kisses. Muriel seemed incapable of expressing any physical affection. Bob and John increasingly sought emotional contact and family life outside their home, and were all but adopted as surrogate sons by their friends' parents. Bob dressed in tie-dye overalls, let his hair grow, and hung out with hippies. Though Michael seemed to have few close friends in high school, he seemed content, even eager, to stay at home with their mother whenever she was there. Michael's aunts, Louise Scharf and Ruth Miller, and other relatives were concerned about Muriel's blatant favoritism toward Michael, but she always defended it, saying Michael was much smarter than the other boys, was gifted, and needed special attention. Louise and Ruth disagreed. Michael was undeniably smart and talented, but so were Bob and John. Virgil's sisters thought Michael was arrogant and rude, in part because he was spoiled by his mother. Once, when relatives were visiting the Swango home, some from out of town, Michael entered the living room, looked them over briefly, then went to his room without so much as saying hello. On another occasion, Muriel mentioned to Ruth and Louise that Michael had wrecked his car. "What happened?" they asked. Muriel said, "I don't know." "What do you mean you don't know?" "He didn't tell me, and I didn't ask," she replied. After Bob left home, Muriel complained to Ruth that she had to hire a yard man because Michael didn't want to mow the lawn. "If I had a strapping young man like you do at home, I certainly wouldn't hire someone," was Ruth's indignant reaction. Yet Muriel seemed indifferent to their concern. As the family members said on many occasions, for Muriel, the sun rose and set in Michael. Given Virgil's work in Vietnam and devotion to the American cause, Bob's dress friends, and increasingly anti-war politics were bound to cause trouble. Muriel expressed no views of her own on the Vietnam conflict, saying only, "Your dad's there, so you should support him." But Bob and Virgil argued violently on his rare visits home and grew increasingly estranged. Muriel worried that Bob's views would influence Michael and John, and that further conflict might erupt in the already fractured family. Bob graduated early from high school and enrolled his freshman year at Quincy College. In the spring of 1970, he wrote his father a letter reiterating his opposition to the war and concluding, "How can you call yourself a Christian, doing what you're doing to these people?" He showed the letter to his mother. "You can't send that," she protested. "It will really upset him." Despite the warning, Bob posted the letter. Several days later, Muriel told Bob that his father was flying home to see him. When Virgil arrived after the 22-hour flight, he met with Bob alone, grim-faced and determined. Virgil said his son was nothing but a commie fag, gave him $20, and ordered him out of the house. He had paid for one night at a downtown hotel, after which Bob would receive no financial support and would be on his own.
"I find black men very attractive to you."
"Yes, but I can understand that. This happens all down through history. White men have it more than you. Probably including the one that you have, if he ever went to NAM or someplace."
"Yeah, he was."
"He's got a long record." "You say yes?"
"He was in Vietnam."
"He was in Vietnam."
"Right."
"Oh, okay. Poochie House." "Okay, maybe."
"Right."
"I don't know." "All right. But one thing that white men do everywhere they go."
"What do we get for $10? "Everything you want. Everything? Everything."
"Oh. Don't do that, baby.
Second installment all done. We'll pick up next week, middle of chapter 2, Katherine Massey Book Club. Not being played for the 50-year anniversary of hip-hop, so-called, although I did see this song to Live Crew specifically because they had to go to the Supreme Court and all that freedom of speech. Constitution Fuller talks about that. They did bring that up, but I mean, really. The reason I'm playing this is because that infamous refrain is from Full Metal Jacket. What's Full Metal Jacket about? White people killing in Vietnam, and then they got to take time to do some sexual sewering, gutter sex of the non-white females. Much obliged, Neely Fuller, giving us the assist. That's why I said, like, oh my God, what did they leave out of the abridged version of this text? The number to dial, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Do not wait till the last minute. If you have observations, thoughts, questions, why did this book start with Zimbabwe? Let us know. I'll make sure to include all of our emails as we proceed. Again, Quincy College prominently featured investigations about Catholic Church sexual molestation of children in the state of Illinois. Quincy College is mentioned repeatedly. Email number two. This is Lauren, one of our longtime participants for the book club. Hello, Gus and callers. I'm pretty excited about this book. It seems especially relevant after old Lucy Letby previously mentioned. I can't call in today, so I typed some notes. Chapter 1, he took the usual pre-college course load, but the only topic in which he seemed to show unusual interest was the Holocaust, which was covered in world history. He ranked in the 97th percentile on his college aptitude tests. White people study war a lot, especially World War II. I think maybe we should too. Maybe if we better understand that event, then we could better understand racism, white supremacy. Dr. Welsing went to Germany too. A 1972 yearbook picture shows Michael in his band uniform smiling with tousled blonde hair. Curiously, in the same yearbook, he is described his ambition to be an Illinois state trooper. This white man just wanted to be a race soldier. We talked about that before. Policeman, that is a job where you can have a gun legally, maybe even kill some folks, many folks. 3, one day Dr. Roland Fulce, the chairman of surgery, led a discussion of x-rays, put an x-ray on the screen. This is the one where he couldn't recognize the heart. What? You're almost done with medical school and you don't know what the heart looks like on an x-ray, and this comes right after you do a project or presentation on open heart surgery? Affirmative action. 4, it happened often with Swango. A standing joke among the students was that if they wanted to get rid of a patient, they should assign Swango to do an H&P. One day, Zawadniak mused to Sweeney that unusually often it seemed when he assigned Swango to do an H&P, the patient would suddenly code, meaning suffer a life-threatening emergency. Do you think it was just a coincidence? But even Zawadniak spoke, he dismissed the thought, and the two laughed it off. Swango was correct, after all, that death is a regular occurrence in a hospital. Zawadniak, Sweeney, and many of their classmates were developing a black sense of humor under the twin pressures of medical school and hospital life. After about 5 deaths in patients who seemed to be recovering satisfactorily, all of them soon after an H&P with Swango, Zawadniak coined a nickname for his seemingly disaster-prone protege, Double O Swango. I've thought about that book, The Gift of Fear, several times since I started reading this book. The jokes people tell in the workplace, pay attention to them, many a truth said in jest. See that black humor, that's what old Sue said. She had the Negro humor to deal after the bombing. See? Chapter 2. The Swango family lived in Fort Benning, Georgia. Isn't that where Joseph G. Christopher was stationed? Yes, it is. And Eric Rudolph. And Timothy McVeigh. And it was even mentioned in Columbine. Number 2. Virgil visited once every 6 months and then seemed only too eager to return to Southeast Asia. A photo from his time in Vietnam shows him relaxed and smiling, sunbathing. Welsing moment. On a webbed lounge chair outside his trailer with a drink in hand. The white father did not seem to want to be with his family, but he was relaxed and smiling when he was in a war zone. See American Sniper for sure, because he was exactly the same, even after they had a newborn. He was like, Chris Kyle, I'm talking about. I'm good. Let's go back and kill these savages, these dark people over in Iraq. Yeah, I got more notches to kill, you know. Sit around here and take care of those children. And that's Lionel too, right? You don't want to do no. I can't do all this with Jeff, man. I got to get back in the lab, man. Wife is crazy, popping pills. I got to go. Let's see. Number 3. At the same time, Muriel was oddly distant and emotionally. We heard that too, right? That was Joyce. I don't want to messing around with Jeff. Got pills to take, man. Matter of fact, some of y'all said that was Sue, too. Said she didn't really want to be messing around with Dill. Do this parenting stuff, man. Got pictures to paint, man. Got these rats to fend off. Get these cracks in the pool corrected. Let's see. They rarely saw Muriel kiss or hug any of the boys or display any affection toward them, nor did they ever see her cry. At Christmas, none of the boys' presents were ever wrapped. Muriel simply put them in paper bags, which she stapled shut. This seems to be a trend. Jeffrey Dahmer, Dr. Swango had mothers who didn't show affection, and she wouldn't even wrap their Christmas presents. Dang, that's cold. Unwrapping presents is like the best part of celebrating white Jesus' birthday. Number 4, I guess getting the gun, maybe, for white people. If the gun, that is, go do some shooting. Number four, Virgil was tall, handsome, solidly built, sociable, had worked for his father in the Recorder of Deeds office before joining the Army. White people get to make sure their children can work with them. Most black people can't do this. Most of us don't even have great jobs, and even if we find one that pays okay, we typically can't help anybody else with employment, but this is how most white people get jobs. Also, it seems like that word handsome has been used several times to describe Dr. Swango and his father. I think it's just a code for white. Probably, but yes, it has been used a lot in this book, and it seems like it's close generally to handsome blonde. Handsome blue eyes. Like, they'll be close in proxy. Not always, but that's part of the handsomeness. White. In the spring of 1970, he wrote his father a letter reiterating his opposition to the war and concluding, "How can you call yourself a Christian doing what you're doing to those people?" Good question. Dr. King-like question. He showed the letter to his mother. "You can't send that," she protested. "It will really upset him." Despite the warning, Bob posted the letter. Several days later, Muriel told Bob that his father was flying home to see him. When Virgil arrived, the 22-hour flight. He met with Bob alone, grim-faced and determined. Virgil said his son was nothing but a commie fag. Gave him, I don't even know what a commie fag is. What exactly is a commie fag? What does a commie fag do that no one else does? Like, break that down for me, Dad. And then see what he says. I'm like, what is that? Are you just name calling? Let me see. And $20. I don't know what that would be inflation, but that I don't. Maybe $200. I don't know. It's kind of that's for like life. Like, dang. Ordered him out of the house. He had paid for one night at a downtown hotel. After which, Bob would receive no financial support and would be on his own. Well, that's like you're gonna practice white supremacist racism in the way that I think. You get your hippie self on out of you, commie fag. Dang. You're not even a man. You don't practice. He said the dad is cold. He flew 22 hours to call his son a commie fag and kick him out of the house. Wow, both of these parents seem unfeeling. Well, it seems the dad feels anger and the mom seems to like murder. She and her son do get to bond over that. Are these the things on the list of psychopathic characteristics? I don't know, but that would include the mom too, right? See, that's what I mean. Like, when we start including all of these, that's four books in a row. When you start having this big list, like, now, dang, we're really saying more about the collective white identity, methinks. I could be in error. Let's see. Much obliged. Make sure I get our other email as well. Email number one, I just didn't read what their notes were for chapter two because we hadn't got that far. Chapter two, number one. Page 27, Virgil died from cirrhosis of the liver. He struck her. Family moved 16 times, put the boys through their paces, whipped Bob with a belt. Boys roamed the neighborhood unsupervised. Muriel seemed to be determined to be a good mother. This chapter reminds me of the dysfunction in Jeffrey Dahmer's family. Yep, the author seems to be making excuses for this lousy mother. Lousy parenting in general. Even all that moving around, I'm not making excuses, but that is old Reb, remember? He lamented about that, even in the basement tapes, like, see there, you all were in the military, Dad was in the military, Wayne Harris, that you all made, moved around, and I was the brunt, always having to start out at the bottom, and it's so hard, and I mean, that is rough, having to move 16 times, that is a lot of moves, as a child, even as an adult, that would be hard. Two, she loved mysteries and true crime thrillers. This seems eerily prophetic. On the one hand, I would like to say yes, but on the other hand, like, that is so widespread. Sue Klebold, every movie that she mentioned was about killing. The Samurai and Arsenic and Lace, everyone, it was about killing. True crime is so popular. Dylan Reb, they loved Charles Manson and all of that. It's so widespread. I certainly don't think everybody who watches true crime is, you know, going to go out and do some Jeffrey Dahmer or blow up the high school, but this is a system of white supremacy, racism, the violence and mistreatment is there, and a lot of the true crime is about mistreating non-white people. Jeffrey Dahmer. Anyway, oddly distant, emotionally. Christmas presents, none ever wrapped. Wait a minute. Wow, it just sped through that. That's wacky. Let's see. Get back here. The cursor is misbehaving. Let's do that again. Oddly distant emotionally. Christmas presents, none ever wrapped. Paper bags, stapled shut. White people don't care about children. I feel like that could be said like many times for many reasons throughout this. Four, Virgil took him aside in a serious tone, told him it was time to teach you the bloodlines. That was all his father ever had to say on the subject. What does this even mean? I'd have to agree. Like, I was like, what? This same thing with commie fag. Like, what? Being coherent, man. You're just talking gibberish. What? What? Five, but he made little pretense of any interest in the family. Reminds me of Lionel. Yeah, and Kyle from American Sniper, Chris Kyle. Virgil Swango kept the copy of the photograph for the rest of his life and made it a point of showing it to Michael. He may have witnessed the execution since he was in Saigon at the time of Virgil's. At the time, Virgil's fascination with death was obviously passed on to his son. That's, you know, you brag about in the system of white supremacy of death making. You know, I was at this battle, and I was at this war, and I was at this surrender. I was there for this bombing. I was there for this execution. I was there for this hanging. Like, that's, you know. Seven. Got this brain, remember? Seven. Jeffrey Duff. Yeah. Seven. Gokong Province, located in Mekong Delta. See, they got all these, got to pronounce all this. South of Saigon is often cited as one of the few successful U.S. efforts at pacification of Vietnamese countryside. Suspected racists are masters at using euphemistic language to minimize their dastardly deeds. For reals. This is like Agent Orange and all that is what they're talking about. Eight. He lived in a mobile home decorated with knickknacks he picked up during vacations in Southeast Asia. Perhaps the reason for his silence was that he was living with a Vietnamese woman. Did he keep any body parts as souvenirs of his kills? Oh, Lord. Woof. Yikes. Incidentally, they got whole volumes at the libraries on this right here. Just the Vietnam component, the war babies in general, that's a big topic. That's like the whole library to itself. But just the Vietnam babies, the Eurasians and all of that, they have whole bodies of work talking. We talked about some of this with Richard Bernstein way back in 2009, the East, the West, and Sex, that's what it is, the whole world as the white man's brothel. That's one of the chapters in the book specifically, but he talks about Vietnam at the Full Metal Jacket. That's why Two Live Crew made that a sound clip. One of the things that we look forward to, we go over here and bomb these dark people, and then we take the, rape the ladies, sir, and children. Let's see. Nine, she left a supply of TV dinners in the freezer, and the boys simply heated their own meals. Thanksgiving, she baked a turkey and made a rolls, but then there was nothing else on the table. White people don't care about, I said, you can say it many times, I just said that. Ten, Michael began buying copies of the National Enquirer, scanning its pages for its sensational crime stories. He clipped some of the articles, and Muriel helped him assemble them into a scrapbook. I've heard of kids collecting stamps and coins, stories of murder. I suspect it's probably more common than you think. I mean, people collect crime novels, right? I've certainly been to people's houses, and with all the true crime paraphernalia, that's pretty common, right? It wouldn't surprise me at all if people, especially back way before you had the internet and all that other stuff, yeah, you just collect newspaper clippings about Charles Manson or Ted Bundy or the Zodiac Killer or whatever the case. I'm pretty sure. And it was books. Like I said, all those romance and whodunits and that type of thing. I'm sure that was not that unheard of. I could be in error. 11. Virgil said his son was nothing but a connie fag. Gave him $20 and ordered him out of the house. This is the second book of this year in which the child is thrown out of the... Sue told you she did not keep saying that. Fresh Princess said that last time. Y'all keep repeating lies and rumors. Sue was very specific about that in the memoir. She said she did not toss her younger son. Pardon. Sue said explicitly, emphasis, she did not toss her older child out of the house. It was a mutually agreed upon parting. She said they had intervention. They sat down, talked about it, all the rest of it. He wanted to be out, fly the coop, as they say. She did not toss him out on his ear. Got to talk bad about old Sue, man. And that's as far as we got for this week. We'll have to discover or get to the rest of it later. Let's see. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Okay, let's see. My notes for the second section. Let's see. Make sure I kick back. Breeze, Illinois, where they went briefly. That is a racially restricted region, so-called sundown town. And even specifically about Breeze, this is James Lowen's site. We read Sundown Towns, his book. So circa the time period that the Swango clan would have been there in 1960, according to the U.S. Census, Breeze, Illinois had 3,546 residents, zero Negroes. 1970 census, 2,885 people, two Negroes. 2010 census, 4,442 people, eight Negroes. For sure, let me give the extra comment. According to local genealogists, they all seem to have the same kind of law that you could come to town, but couldn't stay past 5 p.m. Called it a law. During the same year, in the 1960s, Chicago Carver High School traveled to Breeze for a basketball game. A fight broke out before the end of the game, and the game was called early. I've heard that story frequently. One resident said that he heard there is a Klan cemetery in town on private property. This is from a 2010 email. All of this is on the Tougaloo education site for James Lowen for Breeze, Illinois, B-R-E-E-S-E. Let's see. For chapter 2, they said Swango had a bright future as a doctor. This reminded me of Dill and Reb and so many of these white people. They have bright futures. It takes a lot for the Negro clouds to come in and mess up everything. I thought it was important that Mike's brother thought that, and particularly Bob being upset that he gets all this attention from his mom, Muriel, thought that his whole put-on persona of this earnest young professional was an elaborate charade. And I thought that was important just because the entire system of white supremacy is based on lies. You have a lot of elaborate charades going on, you know, for lots of different reasons, you know, to pretend that we are about justice, pretend that we are not racist, pretend that we actually did some studying. This isn't some old fake resume and nepotism and cronyism, how I got this job or got into this school or whatever it is. The cirrhosis of the liver, doesn't that moron say sobriety would be best? Yes, he does say that from time to time. Let's see. Following prolonged bout of heavy drinking, altercation in which he struck her first time, last time. That's one I will give Muriel credit for. She says she had it. She would not tolerate physical abuse, and she insisted that he move out. That is first time, last time. Logical behavior. Fort Benning, we talked about that one. Bunches, yes, seems like the tough white dudes go to Fort Benning for training. Let's see. Letting the children run wild, unsupervised, let them watching professional wrestling. That's why. But that is all that violence. That is, I mean, it's violence is all over the place, and the racism. So it would not surprise me. They watching all that, and then they want to go and pile drive everybody and grab a chair and bust you upside the head and all the rest of it. So, yeah, I got it. That's sad, though, that you have other white people like, man, you are not even doing your job as a mother. That is a big theme we've heard, even with the JonBenet Ramsey case. I said that white parents, Jeffrey or Lionel Dahmer, white parents having to publicly question, like, did I do an adequate job as a parent? And even the public saying, no, you did not. Obviously, the answer is no. Duh. See, the boys were no more unruly than most children at their age. Now, given what we've read with Dill and Reb and Jeff and everybody, they didn't bought the school, so, yeah. Despite the Mira seemed determined to be a good mother. She read to the children, helped them with their homework, created math problems for them. She belonged to the Book of the Month Club and was always giving them books. Now, sans the emphasis on true crime thrillers, and killing and death and all that, that is it right there. Reading, Book of the Month Club, we go to the library, we go to the university library, we read. Not in front of that screen, reading. Talked about the distance and coldness. It's got that German background. But I don't know what influence that has in all of this, but that's maybe a better white stock. I don't know. Let's see. We got a shout out for Tacoma, Washington, a little bit south of here, right on Tacoma. Let's see. Virgil moves. He returned from Vietnam in 1963, March on Washington, and he is assigned to teach military science at the ROTC. I don't even know what that entails at Texas Christian University in Fort Worth. I even paused. I just mentioned Coach Prime. They started their season going down to defeat Texas Christian in a stunning upset. But what is military science? Like, what is all that? And then he eagerly volunteers to get the heck out of here. That is so Chris Kyle. We heard that exactly. An American sniper. You can stay home with your family, be safe, raise your children, or go back, kill, or be killed. No thought about it. Can we leave today? Can we leave in the next 5 minutes? I got my bags packed right now. I never even unpacked. Can we leave right now? I'm ready. Let's dip. What about your new child? Can we leave right now? I don't even like them that much. Let's go. Let's see. He made little pretense of any interest in family life. I've heard that before, man. That's another. White people do not care about children. That's Lionel Thomer too, man. Can we get back to the lab? Can I get a cab? Can I get back to the test tubes? I'll be back in my element, man. Let's see, a bright, shining light. Didn't I just say that's what the system of white supremacy, primary weapon, Neely Fuller Jr., lying. I'm sure that is a fascinating bit of research. They've been talking about Oppenheimer and all of that. What was the CIA doing with this Phoenix program and all of this against these non-white people? I already said Agent Orange. We probably don't even know the half in terms of whatever sort of weaponry or whatever else that they were doing. Some of this is in Colin Powell's autobiography, where he talks about Me Lai and some of these massacres and what have you, and his involvement in all of that. But I mean, we probably don't even know the half. Let's see. This section where they talk about Virgil Swango and he's like naive about what he's doing and he believes in the mission and they're fighting the enemy, but this is in quotes when he's saying all that. Who does he think the enemy is? Is it the commie fag? Like, who? Break it down. Like, just let me know. Who do you think the enemy is here in Vietnam? Let's see. Say Virgil, he's over here in Vietnam, you know, all the violence, war, and all the rest of it. Mention his children, none of them. Wife, nah. They say he knew he was married before, but like married right now? Nah. Like right on. They said, Muriel, what's she interested in? Bowling, heard that before. I told you where this one ends up, going back to Columbine. Let's see. And they said the family, we don't miss old Virgil. They said there was almost a sense of relief among his sons that Virgil had returned to Vietnam for what seemed an indefinite stay. Dang, is that bad? We just glad to have him out of the house. Thank God. Incidentally, Dr. Curry, he does point out when they jump on black people and say, you know, black people are dumb and don't know how to parent, because we beat our children. Not all, but sometimes they'll make these sort of general wide statements. And he says that for many, many poor white people, he says the evidence is pretty overwhelming. The more education, the more income that you have, the lower the numbers of parents who use corporal punishment to discipline their children. For white people, non-white people, for everybody. That just is the general trend. More education, more income, you know, more parenting skills, so you don't have to beat your child to discipline them, he says. But lots of poor white people, uneducated white people, they beat their children. Case in point right here. Let's see. So we got all this favoritism where they defend the extra attention that Michael Swango gets as a young child because he's so bright and smart. He's a little genius. And Bob is not so smart, so he doesn't get all of that. And then they bond around true crime and murders, which that is essentially the system of white supremacy racism. White people are not friendly. We say that all the time. People talk about black people, so-called, don't have friends. This is not about friends. White people are not friendly with each other. They talk about World War II. That's a whole bunch of people classified as white bombing, killing each other in huge numbers, even getting Negroes to help them do so. That's not because we're friends. What they bond around is mistreating Negroes. And you see that over and over. This is just seeing it on a micro scale. But that's where the bond is. We would be fighting each other, but we can unify around maintaining global white domination over these dark people. That will help us keep down some of our internecine conflicts. We would have white people killing other white people, which is not supposed to happen. It's not even that many of us. It's supposed to be aimed at the dark people. Just my thought process, the bonding with mother, son. Even that's broke apart, see? When the son, when Bob says, hey, I'm going to be a hippie. I'm going to let my hair grow out and all this Woodstock stuff. It seems appealing, man. Dr. King message, it broke through to me. You know, you shouldn't be over there killing those non-white people, man. They never called me Negro or anything else. Why don't you leave those dark people over there alone? It's a what? You commie fag. See, you're not even a messy, see? Your manhood, not even being a man talking that way. Just the thought process. Could be wrong. We're in middle of chapter 2. Pick it up. We just started, so be back next week. Jot down your thoughts, observations. You can ponder on it. Why do we think this here book starts off in Zimbabwe, of all places? Lots of different ways we could have kicked off this text. Other doctors have done this sort of thing, right? So he could have linked it that way. Or it's lots of ways he could have started this book. He starts with a white man sticking a needle in the rear end of an African male. Is that the hook? That's what we need to really... Wow, you got us, man. Wow. This was what I was like, really? Like, okay. All right. Anywho, we'll be here Friday, Neutralizing Workplace Racism, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, and Saturday, Compensatory Call-In, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Much obliged, folks tuning in, live archive, hopefully worthy of your time and energy. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you're so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.